Now let's go to our newsmaker line and get our guest, Mark Sargent.
This is Mark.
Hey, Mark, Daniel Lott of the Edge Television Broadcast.
Hey, Daniel, how are you doing?
Outstanding, my friend. How you be out there?
Pretty good.
Oh, man, it sounds excellent. Where are you at right now, Mark? What city?
Boulder, Colorado.
Boulder, Colorado. Okay. Now, are you at a high elevation yourself?
Yes.
Because I was wondering, does the marijuana smoke like rise up the mountainside or something?
That's pretty funny, because I'm pretty sure that Boulder created 420.
Yeah.
Yeah, that holiday in April where everybody's supposed to do drugs.
Mark, may I ask, did you partake?
No, I didn't. I didn't go to CU. I grew up in Seattle.
Oh, okay.
So.
Okay. Well, now, Seattle, they're pretty advanced that way, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. Actually, Washington's the only other state I know that's it's almost identical rules to Colorado.
Hmm. Okay, well, I'll tell you what, I'm glad to have you on the broadcast tonight, and we haven't specifically dedicated a program in the 11 years this show's been going on since 2004. We haven't specifically dedicated one to, I say flat earth theory. I mean, we can talk about it as the stream of consciousness dictates, but that will be the main thrust of the night's process. But we never have dedicated a program, so I'm looking forward to what you've learned. And just even by copy and pasting your bio, it says that you have done a lot of research on it, and I guess in the beginning, tell us how you began to go down that road to even question it or to look into it. What led you to that?
Well, like a lot of people that have looked at conspiracies, I jumped on this last summer, and it was really because, you know, I looked at just about all the garden variety conspiracies over the years, and this one kind of came across my plate, and I didn't give it much credit. I thought I could knock it out in like a weekend. Mm-hmm. And what I did was shortly after that, I got into this and looked at it from a debunking standpoint. I was going to knock this thing out in a weekend and not really give it any credit at all. And once I dug into it, it turned into a Pandora's box. The more threads I pulled, the worse it got. To where I was looking at plane flights and what was going on in Antarctica and Admiral Byrd and NASA. And before, you know, I got too far, you know, 9 months later, you know, after trying to debunk it for all those months, I jumped in like February and just woke up in the middle of the night and said, you know what, this thing's got more credibility than I initially had thought.
Hmm. Well, there's things in that I've researched over the years. I mean, and I think if people look back maybe 20 years ago, what they believed then and what they believe now is different. Well, how could anything change if what they believed then was a fact? But what changed is the truth started coming through in one way or another. So,
yes.
So that's why you can't just really dismiss the idea of looking into a flat earth view. Because in 20 years, there may be additional information. It's like the planets. They keep changing whether or not we have 9 or 10 planets or whether they even are planets. But you can find plenty of books 20 years ago that tell you exactly how many there are and exactly what they are. And they're not that way.
Yeah, agreed. And you're right. If you would have brought this up to me last year, you know, in the spring, I would have laughed you out of the room. Absolutely would have laughed you out of the room. In fact, I don't even really use the term flat earth when I'm talking to people about this. I use the term enclosed world, which is what my website is, enclosedworld.com. Because I can mention, like, the Truman Show to people all day long, and people don't bat an eye because, you know, it's a good movie. It's an interesting thought about a man who was born into a Hollywood studio that was shaped like a dome that was about 20 miles wide. I can bring that up to him all day long, but as soon as I bring up flat earth, you get this knee-jerk reaction of you must be crazy. You know, it's archaic religious belief or it's ancient science, and it doesn't make sense to them. And then I come back and I say, okay, and for those of you who are listening out there, it's like, look, how do you know it's a globe? Can you prove it to me? Because I tried to prove it for 9 months. I tried to absolutely, you know, just dig in. And then I got to the question. It's like, okay, how can you prove it to me without using the word NASA? And then it got even harder. to where now, and for whatever reason, this year, more material has been released on this, not just me, but other people. More material has been released on this than all other years combined. And it's amazing.
There are satellites in geosynchronous orbit, and most of us always see the video of, say, the Earth spinning. But normally, when we see what is supposed to be a satellite in geosynchronous orbit, the Earth seems to rotate in less than a minute. Is that even possible?
No.
But isn't that what we see? Isn't that what they always show us?
Well, yeah, they do. And what they show you is very, very limited. And I'll do this in two parts. One, if you try to look up video of the Earth from space, you're going to see very, very few clips. In fact, the most famous one is from 1990. You know, that's a long time ago, and it shows a 25-hour rotation of the Earth, but the weather systems don't change. There's no cloud morphing. The clouds absolutely stay static the entire rotation of 25 hours, and we know that's impossible. But if you want to go further than that, just Google, or whatever search engine you use, Google the Earth from space, and you will see exactly one image, and it's from Apollo 17 from 1972. How is this possible? The rest of it is composites. Yeah, you'll see a lot of globes on the screen, but they're either snapshots of Google Earth or composites that have been made by various agencies. There's literally one picture of the Earth from space from NASA. And so when you bring up satellites, are geosynchronous satellites in orbit? I have serious, serious doubts. In fact, at this point, I don't trust anything about spy planes at all.
Well, if somebody says, well, NASA said it, and I would say, well, isn't that the same organization that seems to have lost all the information on the moon landings? I mean, and
exactly.
This is the organization?
Yeah, it's the same group. How do you lose every shred of telemetry data from the Apollo program? And for those people, again, it's tough to jump into the deep end with this thing, because it is so hard to get your head around right away. But the first thing you've got to get rid of is the moon mission. It's just not there. The Apollo program has just been dismantled by the internet hive mind to the point where now it's really, it's just cartoonish.
Well, I like that term, internet hive mind.
Yeah. The internet doesn't miss anything anymore. I mean, all you need is a single guy at 3 a.m. in Nebraska to find, you know, the single, you know, just a single shred, just something out of place. For the layman, you know, think of websites like moviemistakes.com, where literally the nerds or the internet hive mind, they go through a Blu-ray frame by frame, and any movie you make, if a coffee cup moves from one side of the room to the other, without the actor moving it, they're going to call you on it. And they used to just look at movies and television shows, but now they're looking at the news and government videos, and they're finding a lot of stuff.
You know, I'm talking about the stupidity of NASA. I mean, they lost the design for the air conditioning backpacks and the battery design and the tires on the lunar on the rover. I mean, they've, you know, it's like, really? Yeah. It's like, well, they got some of the little kids back there just burned them because they were playing with them or whatever. I mean, you know, these are supposed to be the massive minds of NASA. So it kind of reminds me of, and this is a little political, but Marilyn Mosby, the Baltimore attorney who is prosecuting six police officers, sent the gag order request to the wrong judge, and it was thrown out just here in the last couple of days. I'm thinking, this is the woman that you want to charge six office, you know, credible officers. You know, you got to have somebody with some brains, you know, if you're going to start, you know, saying what we say is true. You have to have some credibility. But we've got some questions already piling in for you, Mark.
Oh, yeah, throw them at me.
And so, you know, I don't expect you to know everything, nor I don't expect any guests to know everything. So if we get into a realm that is outside your purview or you haven't researched, it's fine. We'll just move on. And we'll start this from Curious out of the live chat. We get two frames of questions, one from our live chat and one from our fast blast, which is email. So here from Curious, why does the Earth cast a round shadow on the moon during a lunar eclipse?
Perfect. I get that question all the time. You want to know about the moon? I recommend a YouTube channel called Crow777, CRROW777. All this guy does is take high-definition movies of the moon at close range. And he has taken some stuff in the last few years, which is amazing, which really shows, all you have to do is look up something called the lunar wave. And coming from a game design background, which I have, I knew this thing, what was going on there in the first 2 seconds. And you're looking at a resolution issue. You're looking at a refresh issue of the moon. And the only thing that can be, the only time you see that is in simulations. The only time you see that is computers. So for someone to say, because yeah, a lunar eclipse can't be possible in an enclosed system. It has to be artificial. And if you look at this guy's videos, even though he's not an official flat earther slash enclosed world person, it's still amazing to see. You'll be able to figure this out in 2 seconds. But the short answer is it's artificial.
Okay. And here's from Put Yahweh First. He says, Mark, is the Earth hollow?
Very well could be. In fact, I was a big hollow Earth guy for years before I started looking into flat Earth. And what was I going to say here? It doesn't conflict with that model at all. The true hollow Earth people will say that, yeah, it's a sphere with an interior sun on the inside, and you know there's a big culture on the inside. However, from an enclosed world model, there still could be a hole at the North Pole, and there's plenty of room for another civilization to live on the inside. Is there an interior sun? I'm not sure. But most people don't understand that, like, our civilization, even though we live on a broad range, you know, it's a wide band of geography, we live in a very, very thin band of area. So we only live from sea level to 5,000 feet. So there's plenty of room, even in an enclosed world model, for a hollow Earth civilization. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, we're talking about the same people that bring us the world is round are the same people that said the chupacabra doesn't exist, that fluoride is good for you, and that chemtrails are not real. Now, let's back up. They found a chupacabra. They've seen pictures. People have come and had pictures of the chemtrail equipment in the planes, and fluoride has been proved to be a toxic waste, and it's been proven scientifically. So these are the same people that tell us the world is round. So you are absolutely right to question those same people.
Yeah, I had to. I didn't want to. I had at one point probably 8 globes in my home. And I loved the whole globe model. But the more I looked at it, the more I realized this could be the biggest, not only the biggest conspiracy of all time, but the mother of all conspiracies. Because everything fits inside it. And again, I know it's weird, and I know you're probably getting some comments in the chat rooms from people that say, oh, you know, he's nuts, he's insane. But it's like, look, watch the clues. Just Google flat Earth clues. Watch even a few of them, and you're going to understand where I'm coming from. Mm-hmm. It's not that I wanted to, you know, I had an agenda here to promote, you know, the flat Earth enclosed world. I just had so much trouble proving the globe. Mm-hmm. To the point, and because the only people that are reinforcing it are the government institutions, mm-hmm. especially most notoriously NASA and the U.S. government.
Mm-hmm. It just crossed my mind. I mean, the amount of lies that have been propagated against us makes me believe that, and you put it in a Truman Show context frame. You frame it that way. I mean, you could also frame it as a matrix that we're in this virtual reality. They're feeding this information that only helps them. And I know that you're questioning, and my question, and the people out there are watching or listening, whenever you question authority, you're pissing them off because you're not supposed to. The system is geared for you not to question anything, to accept everything they say, so that we'll be good little citizens and they'll be at the top of the heap and we'll always remain in subjugation to them.
Yeah, agreed.
All right, we have another question here. You said this from the live chat again. Oh, how thick would a flat earth have to be?
Excellent. I covered that in clue number 6, which was called depth perception. And from a depth standpoint, it doesn't have to be deep at all. For those people who don't understand what commercial drilling is like, I had to research this. We've only dug down from a commercial standpoint. I'm not talking about military and what might be classified. Only 8 miles anywhere in the world. The Russians tried some deep core drilling. The Germans tried some deep core drilling. And once you get down to about 8 miles, the drill bits start turning into clay because of the heat, and then you can't go down any further. So from our standpoint, we couldn't, once you couldn't drill down any further, it changed the whole model for me. Because we've all seen the the cross sections of the globe where you have all those color bands, and the scientists will say, oh yeah, we know exactly what it looks like from, you know, all the way through to the 8,000 miles, mm-hmm. but they don't.
Right.
So, because they've only drilled down about 8 miles.
Again, that's a great point. The dissected Earth picture. How do they know that? It's like talking about the Big Bang. They say, well, I remember years ago, they said that everything began with something the size, the dot of a pixel of a TV screen. Then they said it's the size of a marble. And then they said it's the size of a baseball. They just keep, and it's like, really? Were you there? I mean, if you're going to tell me the vastness of this universe came out of a speck, and then you tell me the Earth is round, I may not believe you.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And they even say in the Wikipedia thing that they're really just extrapolating. They have no idea what the Earth looks like mm-hmm. down below. But yet in all the science books, they say, oh yeah, yeah, this is what the cross section of our planet. Mm-hmm. This is the cross section of every other planet. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't make any sense. So if you're just making it up about what's in the center of the Earth, how do I know what the rest of the Earth looks like? But to get back to your question, how thick it is, it doesn't have to be very thick at all. It could be maybe, I don't know, 50 miles, maybe. You know, but then, you know, put a civilization underneath that, it wouldn't have to be, it'd be way thin compared to the width. Let's put it that way.
Mm-hmm. All right. We have this question from Johnny in Illinois. This is from the Fast Blast. It says, Mark, are you familiar with the cloud behind the moon, Dave Edgar, Out of Darkness and Into the Talk Show?
I'm sorry, say that one more time.
Are you familiar with Dave Edgar and his belief, and he calls it cloud behind the moon?
No. Oh, I'm not familiar with that one.
We had Dave Edgar on talking about cloud behind the moon. But again, his point is similar to yours, is that there is a world, a structured world that is created for us to believe. And every time we question it, those that are in charge do not like that. And that's really, so I like to do a broadcast where we make them, or we aggravate them, and that's great. Yeah. So let's get to another question. This is from Bransif in Melbourne, Australia. This is obviously a deep theological question. He wants to know, if you get too close to the edge, will monsters eat you?
Ah, that's a great question. No, they will not. Well, at least I don't think so. However, we should probably backtrack real quick and look at the edge itself, and that is in a flat model, and if anyone wants to look it up, it's the azimuthal equidistant model. Basically what it says is that all the continents are grouped at the center, and Antarctica is just a giant spread out, like a giant ring around the outside. So when you get out there, and Antarctica is completely off limits, which we can cover later in a bit, it has been sealed off by the world government since 1959. You can look it up. It's called the Antarctic Treaty. No corporation anywhere in the world, no matter how much money, how much they bribe, they are not even allowed to get to the edge. It's just military and military-endorsed scientific projects out there. So when you get to the edge, what you would expect is you run into a 200-foot high wall of ice. You know, that's the Antarctic shelf. And then it slopes up really quickly to about 2 miles. And then it plateaus off. So the continent is really unique. And then it's no plant life, no animal life, unless you count the emperor penguins on the edge, and I don't. Mm-hmm. But when you get to the interior, that's all it is for hundreds and hundreds of miles until you get to what could be the edge of this thing. Mm-hmm. Could be the dome, could be a force field. We don't know, because the governments aren't letting anybody go out there. So no monsters are going to eat you, but you could get drone striked. Mm. How's that?
Wow. Okay, I'd go with that one. Of course, now, Columbus believed that he would fall off the Earth, and that was one of the main reasons why they didn't want to go across the ocean. How is it that that he came to that belief? Have you researched where that belief of the flat Earth came back through history?
The original, for those who want to backtrack, if our civilization goes back without breaking in history, maybe 5,000 years, the first 4,500 of those years were all flat Earth belief. Every government, every culture, every tribe, every backwater place, they all believed that, including the major five religions, that we lived on a circular type of plane, flat-ish at the very least, with some sort of dome covering. If you're talking about, you know, the Christian Bible, then you're talking about the firmament from Genesis. You know, the firmament which separates the waters above and the waters below. Mm-hmm. 4,500 years. That's anybody thought. Nobody questioned it. 500 years ago, Copernicus and a few others, and maybe some help by the builders themselves, got the globe model going. Mm-hmm. And anyone that was sailing around that time before then, they had to course correct constantly, and they got lost all the time. Don't tell me that Galileo sailed around the Earth. He sailed in a big circle. That's all he did. Mm-hmm. But 500 years ago, then all of a sudden, it became a globe. And it became a globe for an obvious reason for me, which was you had to, I covered this in one of the clues, because human beings have a notorious habit of not being fenced in. We don't like fences. We don't like prisons. And so the easiest way to keep everyone acting naturally is you make the fence invisible. You hide it. And by making it a globe, that way nobody looks for it. Otherwise, you're going to run into problems by the time you get to the 1900s, the internal combustion engine technology kicks in and people are going to find it and then everything changes. Mm. But the short answer to their question is anyone that was sailing around that time got lost all the time. You got to remember that Columbus was looking for India when he found this place, which is why the Native Americans are called Indians.
Mm-hmm. I was just appreciating your comments there, Mark, because I had a guest on recently that when a challenging question was asked, there was dead airspace. There has not been any dead airspace with these questions. And
I'm sorry. No, I've been asked at this point, even though I've only been doing this since February. And by the way, I don't have any feedback anymore, so that's probably why I'm answering faster than I used to, because beforehand I was like having to keep not having to deal with my echo. But at this point, I've been asked just about every question you can think of, so keep them coming. What do you got?
Okay. All right. Oh, wow. Okay, let's get with it. This is from Tom Jones in the UK.
Yep.
He says, Mark, what does the flip side of the flat Earth look like?
Excellent point. If it is not that thick, there's a couple ways you could do this, because people have said, what's outside of this thing? From the top part of it, what's outside of it? It could be a bigger room. Heck, it could be an ocean. It could be an open space with more egg carton crate versions of Earth. However, if you want design efficiency, yeah, there could be a mirror image of this structure underneath us. Are acting with an entire new set of gravity rules. Absolutely. So if you want, let's put it this way. You could have a hollow Earth society underneath it, but if you went down even further, you could have a mirror image facing the other direction, an identical version of us.
Mm-hmm. Mark, I may have to give you something, some meds or something, because now you have to answer this question.
Okay.
When somebody sails off on the horizon, they seem to disappear. There seems to be some roundness. Now, Mark, I don't think you can explain that.
No, I get that question every once in a while. Okay, first off, as a disclaimer, the model that I use does have a little bit of a curve to it. Other people in the Flat Earth Society, which is why I've gotten some flack from the true Flat Earthers, believe it or not, there is some dissension in the ranks there. Mm-hmm. I use a model written by a guy in the 1830s named Orlando Ferguson out of South Dakota, I believe. And it's called, you guys can look it up, the map's out there, it's called A Flat and Stationary Earth, where it is not tabletop flat, but it is more like a roulette table, for lack of a better word, okay, where you have kind of a bulge in the center. Mm-hmm. As far as the ships, though, there have been a lot of videos that have been put out there recently that show when, if the curvature of the Earth is, 8 inches per mile squared, so it gets, deeper and deeper and deeper. There's been some interesting videos out there of people on fairly calm water from the beach taking videos of ships, because our camera technology has gotten so much better in the last 10 years. And what they're showing is a ship you cannot see with the naked eye that's miles and miles away. But when they zoom in, and the zoom capabilities are fantastic now, they can see the whole ship, including, the water line. That shouldn't be, possible. And there's more videos coming out every day. So I recommend anyone that's in doubt, go to YouTube, look up Flat Earth Ships or Flat Earth Water Test. We'll be able to solve this one way or the other within the next few months.
Hmm. Hey, I see somebody in our live chat just put a link of a cloud behind the moon sighting, because evidently it is something that if you're out at night, particularly at the right time, and you can see the clouds. Sometimes they say that cloud is behind the moon. So I look forward to those kinds of things. Somebody says that it is possible. You know what? I'm going to look. I'm not going to say you're crazy. I'm going to look. I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt.
whoever that person is, email to me. I won't look at it during this broadcast, but email to msargent, M-S-A-R-G-E-N-T 23 at comcast.net. I'd love to see it. But that would actually play into my moon is a three-dimensional object thing. Because in this model, if you've ever been to a planetarium, planetariums, yeah, the stars and the planets are all, you know, part of a wonderful image that's up on the ceiling. However, the sun and the moon, I believe, and most flat earthers do too, that they're three-dimensional objects. So if there are clouds behind the moon, wow, that'd be amazing. I'd love to forward that to some friends of mine. Because the moon, I believe, is a three-dimensional object, which is like a giant nightlight, and the sun is a three-dimensional object that's more like a giant light bulb. However, the sun is not 92 million miles away, and the moon is not 237,000 miles away. They are much closer, and people, you know, come back. By the way, I don't want to pick on religion, but people will say, well, you know, didn't they say, you know, God created the sun, the moon, the stars, and the planets and everything? And I say, yeah, that's exactly right, and I'm not taking that away from you. What was not said was how far away they were and how big they were. Mm-hmm. NASA and man were the ones that came up with that idea.
Mm-hmm. Hey, give me that your email address again.
Oh, yeah. It's msargent, M-S-A-R-G-E-N-T 23 at comcast.net. And you can always, you know, it's the end of all my videos under okay. Flat Earth Clues, and right. It's on my website, enclosedworld.com. Okay. You can't miss it.
Jade and I just put that in. She gave me a secret Skype comment, and then we both put it in at the same time. All right. So okay. Here's a Patrick from Nebraska says, could the universe be a hologram?
Yes, absolutely it could. The Matrix, if you believe in predictive programming, The Matrix, The 13th Floor, the 1973 version of A World on a Wire, you know, all these different movies, could Star Trek Next Generation holodeck, could we be in a holodeck? Absolutely. You want some interesting tests? Look up the essence of matter in quantum physics, like the double slit experiment. That'll blow your mind. The fact that, you know, the old news that just about everything that makes us up is almost empty space. You know, we're very, very small particles. Could we be part of a computer program? Yeah, you bet.
Okay. Let's see. What about this question here from Kentucky Girl of the live chat? What about the theory of relativity? Does that apply, or does that still, that model still work with a flat Earth theory?
Well, it might, but it becomes irrelevant because in this model, there is no distant stars or planets. Everything becomes much, much more intimate. In fact, I had a guy ask me that just today, said, you know, does this prove Stephen Hawking is completely wrong? And I go, well, he is, but not for malicious reasons. It's not because he's wrong, just because he based his work on other people that were wrong. I'm sure, you know, he did some fantastic work, but the foundation of his work and the foundation of Einstein's work, they were all based on assumptions that we were in the solar system. They started off with a bad model to begin with. Mm-hmm. So relativity, I mean, yeah, you might be able to see some things, you know, in the stars and the heavens, but it doesn't make any difference now because they're just, you know, you're looking at the inside of a ceiling.
And speaking of that, somebody in live chat asked this question. Could you explain what the Truman Show is? How does that pertain to this?
Oh, theory? Okay. The Truman Show. Wait, the person's. We're assuming they've never watched the Truman Show.
I would expect. Now, I guess everybody has not seen that. So let's.
Oh, okay. That's right. It's a 1998 movie with Jim Carrey. And the premise was that Hollywood, in its infinite wisdom, built a 20-mile-wide, giant, like a giant sports stadium. But this was to simulate a small town on the East Coast. And what they did was they raised a child inside of it, and everybody else in the town were actors. And it was like a moving, you know, reality show where this kid grew from, you know, his every moment was tracked 24/7, and he grew up to, you know, his 30s. But he slowly but surely, when he was in his 30s, through a series of production mistakes, figured out that he was living in an enclosed system, that his world was fake. And it really touched on a lot of weird philosophical issues about, you know, where we are. But from a design standpoint, it worked very, very well. And he, you know, without the production mistakes, he would have never known. You know, he made it 30 years, didn't never had a care, you know, had a clue what was going on. But what I did was, from a game design standpoint, when I expanded that thing out, and you, if you make it 100 miles, how many people can you put in it? When you make it 1,000 miles, how many people can you put in it? But what was weird was, as I expanded it and made it bigger and bigger, it became easier to maintain because you don't need the actors anymore. Once it becomes a certain size, as long as you have natural barriers that people don't like to go, like you make sure it's cold when you go Antarctica or the North Pole, or you run out of oxygen if you go too high. Once those natural barriers are put in place, the population, once you get like a generation or two inside it, they become completely oblivious to it. So they have no idea they could be living in an enclosed system. And that's what I believe, you know, happened to us thousands of years ago. We were put into this place by whoever you want to name. And through a series of very calculated design features, we've become oblivious to the point where now our technology is finally catching up with it. And the powers that be that have been hiding it, in my opinion, since about 1956, can't hide it anymore.
Mm-hmm. All right. I have this question for you. How deep do you think the oceans are?
The oceans are what they say they are. Nothing, mm-hmm. nothing wrong with the oceans. Okay. Because they only go down... What's the Marianas Trench? 20,000 feet, mm-hmm. 30,000 feet, something like that. Yeah. No, the oceans are perfectly fine. Nothing's changed with the oceans. Mm-hmm. That model is literally as deep as they say they are.
Okay. And here's a question from Curious out of the live chat. What shape is the Earth? Are you saying the Earth is a disc that goes on forever, or does it have a limitation?
Okay. And I didn't get into this too much in the beginning, but here's how it lays out. If you guys want to look up on Wikipedia, there is something called the azimuthal, A-Z-I-M-U-T-H-A-L, equidistant map. That map is used by the USGS, and coincidentally, it is also used by the Flat Earth Society. However, the Flat Earth Society map is considered insane, whereas the AE map, I'll shorten it, AE map is considered a legitimate map used by the United States government. And if you're wondering, if you haven't looked it up yet, and you're wondering what that map looks like, it is also the exact map of the UN flag, which was created in 1946, which is a top-down view. If you're looking at the Earth, if you flatten the globe and the North Pole becomes the center and Antarctica becomes the outer edge, what's interesting, though, about the the UN flag is there's no Antarctica on it, which is interesting because it's a major continent. It's almost like they want to put it out of people's heads. Instead of Antarctica, all you have is this big kind of spiky Greco wreath thing that's coming around the outside, for those of you who remember the UN flag. But what's also interesting is that flag was completed in 1946, and from what I can tell, it was not discovered until 1956. And let me go into detail. I know you have lots of questions, but let me
go ahead.
Try to answer this question for him. And that is, yes, it is a disc. It is a disc which is enclosed by a giant dome-like structure. What's the dome made out of? Could be a heavy element, could be heavy water, could be a force field, could be a radiation belt. Don't think for a second that the Van Allen radiation belts that were announced by NASA in 1959, the same year they seal off Antarctica in 1959, was a coincidence. The old saying is, I believe in coincidences, I've just never seen one. But the big thing was, and I got to get this out there, was when Admiral Byrd, who is known more for the hollow earth theory, which was one of your earlier questions, when he went down to Antarctica, he was looking for something. You could tell that he was a point man for somebody, and he was looking for something down there. He spent his entire adult career down there from 1928 until 1956. He died in 1957. He goes on television in 1954, and he announces, and I put this in Clue 2, the Byrd Wall. It's a brilliant thing, and I wouldn't have even made it, but except there was this great footage somebody leaked from a CBS show from 1954, from the Long Jeans Chronoscope show, where he comes on at, you know, between expeditions, and he says, look, Antarctica is the most important continent ever. He goes, it's so resource-rich, it can fuel the entire planet for a long, long time. It's got mountain ranges made of coal, it's got oil, it's got minerals, it's got uranium. He's hyping up the corporations to go down there. Mm-hmm. And then he goes down to Operation Deep Freeze in 1955, runs 1955, 1956. And then something happens. We don't know exactly what happened, but whatever happened was so monstrous that everyone freaked out. The panic was amazing. And everyone left the ice at the same time in 1956. And they put up the treaty almost immediately in 1959. 10 nations signed it, including Russia, England. Remember, they were rebuilding from World War II. They needed the resources. Australia, New Zealand, Argentina, Chile, United States. They put that treaty in place, and then for whatever reason, at the same time, Russia and America started up their rocket program. And within a year of that, they put atomic weapons on top. In 1958, they started firing atomic weapons straight up, both Russia and America. For 4 years, they did this, firing them straight up. No apparent reason. Atmospheric testing, don't buy that for a second. Mm-hmm. Big megaton hits. And they gave up in 1962. But during that time, you know, look at all the stuff that happened. 1958, after the first shots, NASA was formed. 1959, Van Allen radiation belts were announced. 1959, Antarctica was sealed off. And then it just gets, you know, just gets weirder from there. And I have no idea what the question was when this thing started. I'm sorry. I went off on a tear there.
That's great. All right, man. But while you were on a tear, we got a bunch more questions.
Yeah, right. throw them at me. Sorry. I'll try to keep them shorter.
Hey, no problem. I was interested in that. That's good. All right, here we go. What's your response to the experiment that shows that shadows differ from place to place, indicating around Earth? That might be like, say, maybe one of the sun clock or something. I don't know.
Oh, the sundial? Man, it doesn't. It doesn't. That question doesn't bother me. Curvature of the Earth questions don't bother me because there are bigger, you're looking at the small pieces here. There are bigger, way, way bigger questions to be asked. But I'm not going to dodge the question. When it comes to shadows, everything that happens with the sun and the sky, look, if this structure is as big as I think it is, there is nothing that is impossible when it comes to the sky. And by that, I mean, if you want the sun to do figure eights, you can do it. You want to spell out your names and stars? Absolutely possible, especially from a programming standpoint. And I know, you know, your listeners probably don't play a lot of games, but we've been doing a lot of stuff in the gaming world since about 2004, which mimics all of this. It's called an instance, which basically means, here's lack of a better term, I'll do it with stars though rather than the sun because it'll make it a little easier.
All right.
Let's say you have a giant planetarium. A planetarium big enough to where you can have two projection systems, one on one side, one on the other. You have person A, you know, you have John over here and Bill over here. They look up. They think they are seeing the very same stars, but in reality, they are not, because it's two projection systems. So if you want to make a star on one side, make it blue, and a star on the other side, make it green, but they're both in identical constellations, you can do that. You can also do it with the sun's light. There is literally nothing you can't do with shadows. But I know, and whoever sent that in, look, I know you're starting small, but you got to look at other places first. Look at the moon first. Look at NASA first. Look at Apollo first. Anyway, there you go.
Wow. Our moderator, Jade, just put a scripture in the live chat. It says, Revelation 7:1. It says, after these things, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth.
Yep.
Holding the four winds. Wow.
Well, yeah. And there's a wonderful, for those of you, and I don't know the demographics of how many people of your listeners listen to a lot or read a lot of scripture, but for those of you who do, there's a guy on YouTube who, initially interviewed me, and I pretty much turned him into a convert at this point, who has done a series, and it's all, every verse you could ever imagine in, chapter and verse of everything in the King James, he has done a thing on, and his name is Rob Skiba, S-K-I-B as in boy, A. Wow. All you have to do is look him up. Tons and tons of stuff. However, the four corners of the earth, that's interesting you say that, because the map I mentioned earlier, where the flattened stationary earth boy, Lord Orlando Ferguson out of South Dakota, he actually has the four angels standing at the corners of his map. It's fantastic. And I'll even trump that one. And that is, for those of you who are big believers in the second coming, that there's a wonderful thing in Revelations where they're saying that when during the second coming, I think it's Revelations, they say the entire earth can see the second coming at the same time.
It does.
That is always bugged me from a Sunday school lesson because from a globe standpoint, that's really, really tricky to do. I don't care how clever you are. But if it's an enclosed system, it's very, very easy because all he has to do is stand in the center.
Wow. Those are two very dramatic facts right there. And by the way, Rob Skiba, we had him on the program. Great guy. Love him.
Oh, you did? You did have Rob Skiba?
Well, yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Well, okay. Well, he's done some great work recently. It's just amazing what he's putting out.
Hmm. Okay. Oh, man, I got a little hair on the back of my neck stand up on that little diatribe. All right, let's see. Here we go. Guest 964 out of live chat says, are atoms also flat?
Wow, that's a deep question. I would guess no, because computers don't like... If you're talking about... If we're talking about atoms, I do not think they are flat. But that's an interesting point. I don't think anyone's ever thrown that at me. I suppose it's possible that they're two-dimensional or they're flat-ish. Mm-hmm. But I would go... it's not my favorite answer. I'd say no. Okay. I don't think they're flat.
Okay, and we have this question here. Why do planets look round through telescopes?
Oh, because you want them to be round. It's part of the illusion. You want... art imitates life, which imitates art, and so on. So if you want to... Remember, I believe it's not just the authorities have pushed the globe model on us. It's that all they really did was... Their job was pretty easy. They just kept it going. I believe the creator slash builder slash whoever you want to name that built this place... You had to leave certain things in place to make us believe it was a globe. Remember, because if it's a globe, we don't look for the fence. So if it is, if you're looking into the heavens, of course you want to see round planets. But remember, before we thought they were round, we thought they were disks back in the olden days. It was really only when we went to the globe model that everything became a globe at the same time. So we're seeing a globe now, but in truth, I mean, yeah, they could be three-dimensional hologram images, mm-hmm. but... They're just images. That's all they are. They're very, very pretty, very well rendered, but that's all. I mean, yes, you may see three-dimensional things, but again, we can do that now with our own technology.
All right. And this is from Jimmy. He says, Mark, are the mountains in Antarctica, do they keep rising like the H.P. Lovecraft book says?
Oh, that's interesting. I don't think so. I mean, all I know about the Antarctic stuff right now is that, again, it's 200 feet high at the coast, roughly. It, you know, plateaus up to 10,000 feet real quickly. It stays at 10,000 feet. And then there are some high mountains there. Do they keep growing? Maybe. It's hard to say. I mean, it could be a mountainous barrier at the end, but we've got, if that was the case, we have the technology to go over that, you know, with, maybe not with commercial aircraft, but definitely with our military aircraft. So no, I don't think they're still rising.
Mm-hmm. All right. This is from the Fast Blast. John in Pennsylvania says, yep. In the flat earth modality, what causes earthquakes?
Oh, that's artificial, completely artificial. In fact, there's been several people that have mentioned to me when I did Flat Earth Clue 6, which is called Depth Perception, that I said, look, you don't, because they said, well, wouldn't you want to leave like the magma system and you know, molten rock, wouldn't you want to leave that to a natural process? I said, no. Anyone that designs something like this, everything's going to be artificial, including tectonics, including magma systems. And they say, "Well, how would you do it?" I go, "Are you kidding? We're melting rock. We've been doing that for 100 years, you know, even more than that. Giant blast furnaces, pumping magma around to different systems. Tectonics, artificial, absolutely. You don't leave, for a system like this, you don't leave anything to chance that would potentially wreck something, like a giant tectonics shift that would randomly kill, you know, an entire section of the population, or a super volcano that could blot out the sun. You don't leave chances, you don't leave anything to natural processes if you can help it. Let's put it this way. If you got the power, if you got the motivation and the technology to make a structure like this, you do it all the way. You don't half-ass it.
Okay. Well, with that half-ass there, we are at the half-ass mark of the program there.
Oh, cool.
And so, at Mark Sargent, at this point here, we do take a 5-minute break. You remain on the line. We just give people a chance to get some refreshments and then come back the second hour. But before we do, I've got your Enclosed World website in my background. Tell the folks what they can find. And by the way, that's a very well-done website.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. In fact, I didn't even know I'd have to make the website. I had to take a crash course in front-end Java just to put it up there, because I didn't think this thing was going to gain traction. But it's enclosedworld.com, and not enclosed worlds, but enclosed world. And on it is all the clues, all the interviews that I've done so far that were put on YouTube, and all the transcripts. So if you want to download them, you know, all the text from all the clues.
Okay. All right, Mark, stay on the line. We'll bring you back in here in approximately 5 minutes.
Okay.
All right, everybody, you're watching and or listening to the Edge Television broadcast on our Newsmaker line tonight. From Colorado is Mark Sargent talking about the flat earth theory, but I think we've gone beyond the idea that it's a theory. We may be veering closer to the truth than you think. If you have questions for our guest tonight, go to the edgeam.com website, click on the Fast Blast link, or you can join him in the live chat going in now. This program will begin to replay in the main player directly after the show. We'll upload it to our YouTube channel and put it in our playlist at tuneinradio.com, as well as podcasts. So many, many ways to re-enjoy the program. By the way, the podcast and the TuneIn Radio, really, you can stream this show on any device and across any platform. Next week, Noreen Renier, she was a guest on Coast to Coast not too long ago. She is a psychic detective, and she has solved some cases. So let's see what she has to say next week. If we haven't had a guest on the program you'd like to see, just drop us a line. And here we go to the halftime program. And welcome back to the Edge Television broadcast. My name is Daniel Lott. If you have a question for tonight's guest, Mark Sargent, go to the edgeam.com website, click on the Fast Blast link, or you can join him in the live chat where our esteemed moderator, Jade, will garner your questions. And sometimes it helps to put a cue in front of those, because some of you guys like to talk together and have a good old time, but focus on the question. Put a cue in there. Let's go back to our newsmaker line. Mark Sargent, are you back with us?
I am back with you.
All right. Well, welcome back to the second hour of the Edge Television broadcast. Mark, given some pretty good information in the first hour, things I've never heard before, and certainly you're building a case, at least for people, I think, to question, and I appreciate all of the links and the suggested lookups for people to go search for specific things, because to get to the truth, you do have to do your own research, and people need to look at it for themselves. But again, as we said in the very first part of the hour of the show, that look at all the things that have changed, the facts, the so-called facts that were given to us, how they're not facts 10 years later, 5 years later, even almost on a daily basis.
Yeah.
So is there anything, now when we're talking about the topic of flat earth, after you made what I assume there's shocking information to you at some point, is there anything else that you have developed a question of? Well, because that's sort of so obvious, the earth has to be round, just like they said, and spinning around, just like they said. Well, what else is so obvious it has to be that way because they said? Is anything getting your interest up?
You know, there's been a lot of things. Everything that I looked at, that I tried to prove it is round, there were some things that stemmed, that came up that didn't make sense. But I'll throw one out at you, and that was from Clue 7 and Clue 9. Clue 7 was called The Long Haul, and Clue 9 was called The Magic Show, and was based on planes in the Southern Hemisphere, about what should happen in a globe and what doesn't appear to be happening. And for those of you who don't know, I initially, and this wasn't my original idea, I got this from a guy in Germany who posted this little video. He wasn't necessarily a flat earth guy, but what he said was, he goes, look, something's wrong in the Southern Hemisphere when it comes to planes. In the Northern Hemisphere, where you and I are, you can get nonstop flights all day long. It's not a question of if you can get nonstops, it's how cheap you can get them and what time you have to leave. But in the Southern Hemisphere, it's extremely difficult. Almost everything is a connection. And he goes, the connections don't make any sense. Because in the Southern Hemisphere, you know, there's not that much down there, but there is a lot of people. You know, there's two continents. You know, you got South America and Australia, that's the big ones, and, you know, part of Africa. But most of the population is centered in South America and Australia. And he goes, when you're trying to fly from place to place over there, if it's a globe, it doesn't make sense because they keep sending you in routes. So I'll give you a perfect example. If you're going from like Rio to Sydney, Australia, there's no reason why that flight should go straight up into the Middle East and angle back down. Or if you're going to go from Rio to the same sort of flight, there's no reason why it would go through Los Angeles or San Francisco, because it takes this weird arc. I mean, it should be, if you're going from South America to Australia or vice versa, it should be just a straight shot across the Pacific Ocean, 12 hours, roughly, not even, maybe 11 and a half hours. it's an easy flight, but you never get that flight. 95% of the flights in the Southern Hemisphere are connections. They don't take 12 hours. They take 25 hours. They take 36 hours. Some of them are pushing into the low 50s. Mm-hmm. But what's weird is when you take the flat map, the AE map or the UN flag, you know, for lack of a better term, and you lay it on top and you plot that flight from Rio to Sydney, going through Los Angeles, mm-hmm. it's literally a straight line. And that doesn't make any sense. The odds of that happening are remote at best. It should not happen, but it happens mm-hmm. all the time. Every flight that looks weird on a globe looks almost perfectly fine on a flat map. Maybe a little dog leg here and there, but it shouldn't happen consistently, and it does. And so I put that out there as clue 7, and I said, look, you know, take a look at this stuff. Mm-hmm. And people came back immediately and said, well, there's this nonstop from Santiago, Chile to Auckland, New Zealand. Therefore, the flat earth must be wrong. So I sat down for a week and just stared at real-time flight trackers. In fact, the one I used was planefinder.net. Mm-hmm. And I was watching these planes, and I was going, okay, I'm just watching to see if they cross the ocean, how they get there. And the planes weren't going across the ocean. And I was going, wait a minute, where are the planes? And I was a little slow on the uptake, and I was going, okay, so I started zooming in, and I was trying to follow these planes. And once they got about 150, 200 miles offshore, they all disappeared. Their GPS, they were dropped off the GPS entirely. You guys can go look this right now. Just go to planefinder.net. Everything in the below the equator, the oceans are empty. The continents are full of planes. The northern hemisphere looks just fine. The southern oceans are empty, and that's because the planes are made invisible. They are dropped off of GPS. Their individual plane records go to approximated or estimated, and they do not come back until they're about an hour away from touchdown. They magically, it's why it's called the magic show, they magically appear back on screen, and then they land. But because they got from point A to point B, no one has picked up on it for years. They've never looked at it and mm-hmm. said, because, you know, the pilots get there, they run on autopilot, the passengers get there, they're happy, but the routes are hidden. And the routes are hidden because the routes are wrong. You can't cross those oceans in the southern hemisphere if the map is wrong, because it would take too long. So they skirt the coastlines. They fly over land masses mm-hmm. you shouldn't be, but because you're sitting in your seat drinking your vodka martinis, you don't get it. You don't pay attention.
Hmm. Well, and for those of you out there that may say Mark is crazy, that's not a rebuttal to what he just said.
Oh, no. And let me please address that, because every show that I have done, yours is not unique in this capacity, and I don't blame them. Those of you who are listening out there, look, I understand. I was in your shoes. This is no different than Neo in the Matrix when Morpheus sat him down for the first time and says, look, here's where you are. Every other conspiracy does not rattle somebody's cage. But when you tell somebody, hey, the world you're living in may not be the world you're living in, some people really don't like that. They have a severe knee-jerk reaction to that. And those of you who are out there, put in the comments saying, look, he's nuts, he's insane, get him off the air. I totally understand it. I was with you. Trust me on this. And for 9 months, I banged my head on the desk trying to hold on to the globe, and I couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. So now I'm out there putting it out there. I'm not going to beat you over the head with it. I'm just saying it's very, very possible. Mm-hmm. So I completely understand some people, you know, their anger. I've seen
for the last four months. What I was going to say there, though, is that you're crazy is not a rebuttal to what you just said. A rebuttal would be, I went and looked up what you said. I applied my mind to that. I look at the other facts involved with this point on this single point. You know, and you can do it with every point that you've made. I went and I looked, I did my research, but the rebuttal that you're crazy or that you're a liar is not really a rebuttal. I agree with you too. That is, we are programmed to do that. It's like somebody said, I saw an alien. I saw a UFO. The knee jerk reaction we're programmed with is, ha ha ha, you're crazy. There's no such thing.
Yeah,
you know, and it's been that way pretty much for everything. Whether it was even the chupacabra, I mean, that's an easy one there. I mean, that thing is chupacabra. This thing that's going around and eating animals. You know, that's like Bigfoot, and then they started showing up. So the rebuttal to that would be, I went and researched, and in fact, there are chupacabras out there, and so maybe you're not so crazy. So
The YouTube forums are a battleground right now when it comes to this. I have never seen such a polarizing topic, I think, ever. And what's weird is the reaction is coming from, and again, I'm not going to say you guys are brainwashed or it's programming, but look, I was there. And that is when you put a globe in a first grade classroom when you're 6 years old, that's all you have to do. You leave it there. You make it through school. You know, maybe you go to college and do some advanced stuff on top of that. But the entire time, you're seeing the globe in the classroom. So the rebuttals are always the same. And that's like, duh, it's a globe. We know it, right? But it's like, okay, which is why I said in the very first clue in the introduction, I say, look, you're equating it to things that are given, like 1 + 1 = 2 or gravity, right? It's not the same thing. It's a globe because you're told it's a globe. If NASA told you it was a square, you know, 100, you know, when they were created, you'd think it was a square. Mm-hmm. Don't buy everything you're told. I know it's a big one. I know it's a big one. And I do not expect everyone to get this. It comes in layers. Just don't freak out and immediately start swinging. That's all I'm saying.
All right. We had this question. Mark, did the TV series Under the Dome have any truth for us about living under a dome or on a flat Earth?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Predictive programming at its best. I mean, look at the stuff that's come out in the last 15 years, roughly. You had The Truman Show. You had Dark City, which is an Australian production. The Simpsons movie, where the entire plot, the whole city was what? It was put under a dome. The current series, written by Stephen King, not a small-time author, which is called Under the Dome, where a city is literally trapped under the dome. Where's all this stuff coming from? It's almost like, I hate to say this, but it's almost like which could be the reason why it is the topic in the conspiracy world in 2015. It's that it's some sort of revelation is coming down the road where this, you know, the state of our world, the very shape of our world may be changing and they may be gearing up for it.
Mm. And speaking about gearing up, this question came through. It says, does the whole UFO alien story, is that a cover? Or does that cover for the round Earth theory? I mean, does it prop up the round Earth theory to perpetuate it?
It helps the round Earth theory, but only with the alien stories that say they're from, you know, from Venus or Mars, something local. Mm-hmm. But the alien story, no, I absolutely believe it. I've seen spaceships flying around, especially out here in Colorado. It's clear skies. I use night vision binoculars, have been for years. Most people don't know that. 90%, more than that, 95% of any spaceships you may think do not run with their headlights on. They do not use their running lights. They work like cars. They work just fine with the lights off. In an enclosed system, they become much more relevant, meaning they could be the superintendents. They could be the maintenance team. They could be the frickin' janitors for all we know. Do they sort of reinforce the globe? Only if you think of them from coming from another planet. But a lot of people have said that they could be interdimensional beings, which means they could be living in another dimension right on top of ours. Or they could be living right outside the dome. So I think it's kind of a push on both ways. They sort of reinforce the globe, but they also work very well in an enclosed system.
James West says, this is a question, he is not being facetious, but is the flat earth easier for people with flat feet?
That's funny. I've never gotten that one. No. Flat-footed people still have a hard time regardless. Mm-hmm. But that's really, really funny. No, because I've known some flat-footed people, and they're horrible to watch because, you know, they can't run worth a damn.
Mm-hmm.
No. Flat-footed people would not have an advantage on a flat earth. That's a great question, yeah. Though.
It'd be hard. It'd be harder for the hobbits too, because they got those big old giant feet, you know.
Yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
All right. We've got this question. This is again from Tom Jones out of UK. It says, do you think that the media is propping this up?
Propping up the rounders?
Yes.
Yeah, but not deliberately. They don't know. At the highest levels, this is one of those secrets that is so big that you really have to have a small circle of people. The short answer is no. The media isn't propping it up deliberately. I mean, they just read scripts like they always do. Do they promote the NASA stories? Yes. For those of you who don't know, just check the news. Go back in the archives. Every month, like clockwork, better than any corporation, better than any government, better than any other organization, NASA releases stories because they're reinforcing the globe. So the media helps NASA, but they're not Mm-hmm. You know, they're not spinning it on their own on top of NASA. Mm-hmm. So when NASA says, releases a story through the news and they say, hey, look at this face on Mars. You know, look what we just, look at this interesting thing on Saturn. Oh, hey, we're sending some probes out past Jupiter. Every time they say that, regardless of what you think of what's out there, you're inadvertently reinforcing the globe. Hey, I'm thinking, I may or may not believe that face on Mars, I'm on a globe. Hey, that hexagram on top of, or hexagon on top of Saturn, I'm on a globe. And so on and so on. So NASA has to do this on a regular basis, but unfortunately it's starting to fall flat recently. See what I did there?
Oh boy. Okay. Hey, well, I mean, we're talking about most of our outer world views and information does come from NASA. Certainly, we're not doing it. We're not up in space looking down. They're telling us what it is. Now, so these are the guys, though, that have been caught airbrushing artifacts on Mars and on the moon, and people have testified they've seen where they do that. And then you mentioned Google Earth. Well, there are areas that Google Earth blacks out. Who knows what that is?
Yeah.
So, you know, they're just telling us what they think we need to know, and I don't like them being in control.
Yeah, NASA is starting, and that's my big mission now. I've been starting this for the last month, and that is I'm going after NASA with everything I got, which basically I'm trying to say, look, because people have asked me, they say, who's really to blame for the big cover-up on this since 1956? And really, the gatekeepers, it falls on the shoulders of NASA, which is why they actually called in. Jet Propulsion Laboratories called in during one of my shows. They waited until 10 minutes after I was off the air. With Ground Zero, but they called in. I was going, why were they listening to the show in the first place? But that's a whole other thing. But NASA, I'll give you another example. For those skeptics out there, because look, I can make it easy for you. If we had the potential to take pictures of the Earth in 1957, maybe not good pictures, why didn't they release the first picture until 1972? And why is that 40-year-old picture, 40-plus years old picture, the only sanctioned picture on the internet? There should be tens of thousands of pictures. There should be dedicated geosynchronous satellites that are running television stations showing you the Earth. People would pay for it. You know they would. Why is there only one picture of the Earth from space? Google it, or whatever search engine. You will not find any. You got to ask yourself why. And the only reason NASA would do that is because the Earth is not shaped like we're told.
Hmm. All right. And we have this question from Raul Sanchez. What do you think about people who don't believe in gravity?
Oh, I think gravity's real. I mean, all right.
What do you think of people who don't? I mean, do you think people who don't believe in gravity are crazy?
No, because gravity, look in the mainstream science books. Gravity is tough to define even for physicists now. I define gravity, I'll even go so far as to say I do not define gravity the same way the scientists do. And that is because I come from a game design standpoint. You know, my little backstory is I used to play games professionally. I worked for a game developer. I help produce this stuff, and I've been a lifelong gamer. From a gaming world design standpoint, it's not that just gravity is what you say it is, but let me define gravity in another way. Because, yeah, if you're not on a ball, then what is gravity? That might be where he's going with this. Think of it like this. We all know that magnets attract metals, especially, mm-hmm. you know, certain kind of metals. Mm-hmm. What if you had an element that you could treat like a molecular magnet? Once you had a molecular magnet that could magnetize not only metals, but anything organic, you could pull on anything, and including water, including plants, including anything you want. What's the difference between a molecular magnet and what we call as gravity? The difference is that molecular magnet can work anywhere, including an enclosed system, and that's what we do in the gaming world, and that's what I think mm-hmm. we're doing here. I mm-hmm. think because they say, okay, what sort of gravity are we using here? Some people say it's mass. I think it's molecular magnetism.
Mark, if you had a chance, would you take the blue pill or the red pill?
Crap, which one was it? Was it the,
the blue?
The red? Was it the red pill that took you down the rabbit hole?
Yeah, it was.
I would always take the red pill. Now, that being said, though, that's funny that that person would ask this, because I thought of that recently. I said, look, when it comes to some people, when it comes to this topic, look, ignorance is bliss. Absolutely. And I stole that line from The Matrix when I said that, which deliberately, because for a lot of people, look, shaking up their world, they're not going to be, and people say, well, what does it matter? What does it matter whether it's a globe or a flat earth? And I say, well, it may not affect you directly, but it's going to affect a lot of people. The religious institutions will absolutely have a massive shift because they are going to claim, and rightly so, you know, that it is a proof of intelligent design. Mm-hmm. Is it the handprint of God? Could be. And if it and if it is, it's going to affect everybody around you. Society will change. But we'll get to that in a little bit. I know we have time.
Wow. And I tell you what, I saw somebody wrote in the live chat, said, are we living in a video game? But I would say this, just on that point right there, from a governmental standpoint, we are, in fact, in a video for them. They control us. I mean, you know that they get into groups. They're like the Democrats and Republicans. So the Democrats say, well, if we raise these taxes and we do this, then the people are going to do that. And the Republicans say, well, if we do this and do that, the people are going to do that. They manipulate. They know what we're going to do. And so we're like, it is to them. Of course, they're at the top of the heap. No rule of law applies to them, Hillary.
Yeah.
You know, and so the rest of us is... You know, it's like whether we work harder or whether we don't, whether we go to this doctor or that, they're moving us around like chess pieces. And if the programming, say the game language, is in error, our lives are destroyed. And they go, oh, well, we'll just write another program. But the people already destroyed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, we are living in a game experience.
Yeah, you got a good point there.
Okay, and let's get to this question here. If you had the money, what one thing would you do to prove the flat earth theory?
Excellent question. If I had the money, and we'll see if this happens, there's only one way to really prove it unless you want to charge against the government. Because if you're thinking you can storm Antarctica, you got to think again. You will probably be drone-striked out of existence because there's a multinational navy that protects Antarctica. However, that being said, the one thing – I mean, you could talk about curvature of the Earth test, but that doesn't really necessarily prove it conclusively for me. What is different, though, is on a flat map, the Antarctic coastline is much, much longer, multiples – longer than the Antarctic coastline that they put on our maps currently, which would be just a slightly bigger than, say, Australia. So the easiest way, I'll make it short, you take two ships, you put them right next to each other. One points clockwise, the other points counterclockwise. You put them within visual range of the Antarctic coastline. They just head off in their other directions. Okay. Now, if it is only about the same amount as around as Australia, they should meet each other in about a week. But if it is the flat map is correct, these ships would not meet for a long time, maybe even a month. If you didn't want to wait that long, you could take one boat, just leave it in the 6 o'clock position, give or take, and then take one plane, a long-haul jet, and have it start flying either clockwise or counterclockwise. And in 13 or 14 hours, it should run into that boat again. And if it doesn't, well, then you might approve something.
All right. And we have this question from Melbourne, Australia. Do you believe in the geocentric model?
No. And here's why. The geocentric model really says, if you want the official geocentric model, and don't quote me chapter and verse on this, is that we are the center of the universe and that there's an actual universe around us. So The flat Earth model or the enclosed system model that I use isn't really geocentric because the planets aren't really out in space and the sun isn't 92 million miles away and everything like that. So it's not that everything revolves. It's not this giant scope. Everything is much, much smaller. And the reason is because if you have an enclosed system like this, you don't need, because people have asked that all the time. It's like, well, is there space outside? Is there outer space outside of us? And I said, well, yeah, there could be, but why would you do it? Because if you're pretending to have space outside of you, that means chances are that there's actually not space outside of you. Meaning, if it's an enclosed system, if you're building small, you simulate big. So there's no reason to build big. You know, if you're building big, if you want to build the entire solar system, well, then that's a whole other deal. But no geocentric.
Okay. Here's a question. It says, is that above and below imagery from secret societies meaningful to the flat earth theory? They always talking about, you know, if you start getting Illuminati and different things, they always talk about so as it is above, so as it is below. There's some kind of something in there that they're trying to say, or some hocus pocus, but is that related? Have anything to do with flat earth?
Yeah, unfortunately it does. I have no doubt that the secret societies, and I'm not necessarily going to, you know, call out the Illuminatis or the Masons, although I know that both of them probably had advanced knowledge on this and probably had the old maps that showed exactly what this looked like. But yes, it for them, they have a much better understanding of what's there than we do. They, you know, I think a lot of stuff that is mimicked outside of this world is also inside this world.
All right. And here's a question from Curious. It says, is the Earth millions of years old?
Could be. Could be. However, what's more important is actually how many civilizations have lived in here. And I don't want to steal a Matrix reference too much, but how many times have we gone through this? Because we all know, you know, that there's been ancient civilizations. We've dug up the ruins. We know there's underwater, you know, cities that have been buried underwater. Mm-hmm. We know that, you know, in India there's been, you know, evidence of some sort of atomic war. Is it millions of years old? Yeah, maybe. But how many civilizations does it go back? And if you want to get even creepier, who was the first civilization? Because if we're talking about enclosure, you know, could it be that the first civilization was the original, you know, occupants, you know, because I don't think we're the first people to rent this apartment, but were the original occupants the fallen?
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting one.
Well, there you go. I mean, with the past and previous civilizations, are the pre-Adamic civilizations, as some would allude to, but they basically have us running around the Serengeti. After we jump out of a tree, we run out of Serengeti, then we build a little hut, then we build a little town, then we build Europe, then we build the West. And it's like, but the evidence says, wait a minute, what was before that? There's something before that that doesn't, you know, there's nothing in any textbook or educational system that tells you that there could have been other civilizations. So all these monoliths and these anomalies out there with civilizations and cities underneath the ocean, there's no comment about them. It's like, don't look over there. That's a manipulation.
Yeah. I mean, the pyramids, to that person's question, the pyramids could be hundreds of thousands of years old or older. Mm-hmm. You know, it's in a very geographically stable location. I've been there myself, and it's a fascinating thing to look at. Mm-hmm. Do I think that our civilization built them? Not a chance. Not a chance in hell. There's no way, you know, that, and who, you know, and even the pharaohs didn't, you know, they said, oh yeah, we build it in 30 years, even though there's no hieroglyph, not a single hieroglyph that says how they did it, because it was so mind-boggling, even to them, they couldn't even come up with a cover story for it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to throw a wrench into that multi-millionaire theorem that's been posed. Just recently, they said they found soft tissue of a dinosaur bone. Now, it can't be that you find the soft tissue, because that dinosaur is supposed to be 30 to 40 million years old.
Yep.
So something's amiss here. Of course, there's also the clay pottery showing people riding dinosaurs and human footprints within the footprint of a dinosaur. So that timeline, there's something in that timeline. They give us this easy thing. Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492 and go to bed, pay your taxes, and go to work. You know, I mean, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Maybe that ain't the way it's supposed to be.
The carbon dating system is screwed up. Everybody knows this. The scientists are holding on to it with their fingernails at this point, and it's not holding up. Yes, could a previous civilization that may not have been that long ago just been a dinosaur civilization where they were messing with animal life? Very, very possible. Because hundreds of millions of years, it doesn't explain things like the plesiosaur that's swimming around Loch Ness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we ever found, if that thing ever washes up on the beach dead, how are you going to explain that to people if you're a scientist? You know, you can't, because it's like, okay, if you find it, it's like, okay, this thing should have died hundreds of millions of years ago. Then why hasn't it, you know, populated the entire lake or the entire, you know, Great Britain?
Mm-hmm.
It's ridiculous. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mark, we have this just a slight comment here. Do you have a Facebook page?
I don't. I'm really not. I don't want to stretch myself too thin. So the only thing that I do right now as far as social media is YouTube. And I don't have a Twitter account. It's just YouTube and my website, enclosedworld.com.
Okay. And this question, do you think that Pangaea existed in the past, or was it a lie?
No, I think Pangaea. Oh, absolutely. In fact, Pangaea works way better in an enclosed system than it does a globe. Because if it's a globe, then you have this big lump, and then the rest is supposedly water, you know, but it's really off-center. and it just doesn't feel the same. But in an enclosed system, all the continents are grouped in the center, you know, towards the North Pole, and then it seems to spread out very, very naturally. So yeah, no, Pangaea absolutely agreed that it was real and that it was probably one of the early versions. I don't know if it was, you know, version 1.0 of this place, but it was, you know, definitely one of the early ones.
Somebody wrote the question in, do you believe that there was a worldwide flood?
Yeah. I don't think you can get away from that. There's too many cultures that have mentioned it. But what the enclosed system does is it makes the worldwide flood much more, what's the word I'm looking for here?
Palatable?
Yeah.
Possible?
Yeah, yeah. Way possible. Because, you know, if you want to talk about the waters separate, you know, the firmament separating the waters above and the waters below, you know, could the waters have just been dumped in? In fact, Rob Skiba even talked today about that he thinks that maybe the flood was all the waters from the above, you know, came in and actually created our giant oceans. So, the Great Flood, absolutely.
Well, and I would say that if the water was already here, it either fell off the flat earth or the other model would be, if you say it's a dome enclosure, it'd have to raise, the water would raise up and it wouldn't have anywhere to go. So the only logical conclusion, it was dumped in.
There you go.
Man, I'm going to have Rob Skiba back on the program.
Oh, you are, man. You really got to talk to him about this.
Okay. I didn't know he had veered off into that.
Oh, he's got about 10 or 12 hours worth of YouTube stuff out there right now. In fact, the one he just released today was another 2.5 hours.
Mm-hmm. All right, and here's a great question. Are there any major scientists that are beginning to crack on this round Earth theory?
Not yet, but it's only because we've only been doing this since February.
I didn't slip up. I didn't slip up on that round Earth theory. I'm saying for them, it's a round Earth theory.
Well, yeah. No, you could have said it either way. I mean, no scientist has renounced this thing yet. Not by a long shot. And they're not going to. It's going to take something else. It's going to take some other things. They will not. They will be the last holdouts. But again, this has only been happening since February. Before then, it was kind of like just a bunch of static. But now it has really gained a whole bunch of clarity, and I'm humbled that I got to be a part of it so far.
And Raul Sanchez in the live chat says he really likes the Rob Skiba videos. But let me ask you something. The people that are watching this show are seeing me on a computer screen, and they would testify in a court of law that I am flatter than a pancake. But I would testify in the same court that I am a three-dimensional being, 190 pounds, 6 foot, all pure cowboy. Who is right? Are the viewers right, or am I right?
All right, I'll answer that question with a question. You remember the that dress story that came out last year with the dress that was either gold or it was black?
You're right. I saw that. That was ridiculous. I saw it.
But how do you convince somebody of that? You've got two people standing next to each other. One says it's obviously white and gold. The other person says it's blue and black. Both sides think they're right, but you're never going to convince them. When it comes to your two-dimensional or three-dimensional thing, I treat it the same way.
Okay. But all
right.
All right. So here's a question. When you die, do you see death taking on... Well, wait a minute. What's this? Oh, I see what he's saying. Do you see death is like taking off a 3D head gaming visor? Is that what you would consider death?
Ooh, that's a good one. I don't know if it's a visor as much as it is. I think it's all encompassing. Some people have said like it's like a visor, like the 13th floor. That's what I think they're talking about, that movie reference. Maybe. But I think it's a little more advanced than that.
Okay. All right. And here's another question. What do the astronauts say about Earth being round or another shape?
Okay, that's a good one, because when I did Clue 11, what I did was, it was based on an astronaut documentary done in 2003 called Astronauts Gone Wild, where I'll answer this kind of in a roundabout way. And for those of you who haven't seen it yet, what basically did was the interviewer came in and was trying to trip him up with some technical questions, but he brought in a Bible and he tells them, hey, can you put your hand on the Bible real quick and say that, you know, swear that you went to the moon? And they treated that Bible like it was made of plutonium and it didn't make any sense.
Or like a vampire in a cross.
There you go. Yeah. It's like, why would they care? Why would they care? Now, I think the Apollo astronauts knew. In fact, I have little doubt at all that the Apollo astronauts were told at one point, just because it's like they figured they could take it. You know, it's like, okay, you're going to be faking this, and here's why. And they reacted badly. You know, they, you know, some of them crawled into a bottle, others, you know, became recluses. It was, you know, none of them, you know, handled it very well. And so after that, they decided, because all the astronauts now are really just Air Force employees, and I think they just signed disclosure agreements where they're told, okay, look, you're going to be faking this footage, but you don't even have the clearance to ask us why. So the current astronauts know? No, no. They know they're faking something, but it's probably easier on them emotionally not to tell them why. The Apollo astronauts, though, I have no doubt they knew.
Mm-hmm. All right. And by the way, we had Edgar Mitchell on here, Apollo astronaut. He wrote a book, Strange Things Happened on the Way to the Moon. We didn't get into round or flat earth theory, but he definitely said that there are things that are out there that have been hidden from us. And he tried to delineate some of those in his book. So,
look at Neil Armstrong's speech from years ago when Clinton was president, where he did that speech. He came out for some anniversary. Mm-hmm. And he said that, you know, you'll be able to solve. He was addressing the graduating class of something, mm-hmm. and he said that you'll be able to solve this if you can remove one of truth's hidden protective layers. Mm-hmm. And that didn't make much sense to me then. It does now.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Now, I mean, it seemed to me he was trying to subtly say you've been lied to, and if you could just get that curtain that's. You know, there's a man behind the curtain lying to you there.
Exactly. But was he talking about a literal curtain? I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'd like to think so now.
Mm-hmm. All right. And how about this? Is the Earth spinning? Is this flat? Is it spinning like a frisbee, like a disc? Is it spinning at all?
No, you can't. Because then you're going to run into that merry-go-round syndrome. And that is, you think that gravity is weird on a globe. On a flat Earth, it literally becomes a merry-go-round. So what happens is, as you move farther out towards what we call the southern hemisphere, you would get a centrifugal force factor to where gravity would start pulling sideways. You get like this side G-force thing, and that wouldn't work out too well. So, no, it doesn't have to spin at all, and really, from a design standpoint, you don't want it to. Mm-hmm.
All right, and Jade, put that quote you just put in the live chat, put it in the Skype thing so I can read it, because I want to read that, and it's going to flip on me real quick. All right, let's go to another question here. It says, Mark, I'm wondering about all the other planets. Are they flat as well?
Same sort of thing as before. And no, they're not flat, but you're never going to get to them. You're never going to reach them. They may be three-dimensional holograms, but they're very, very small by comparison. And like when they talk about the Mars thing recently, you know, even though we don't have any moon bases and nobody's gone back to the moon for whatever reason, mm-hmm. now they're talking about going to Mars. That Mars mission is never, ever, ever, ever going to happen because of the internet hive mind. The detection methods available for the hive mind have caught up with production. So you couldn't, if it was me, let's put it this way, if it was my operation, mm-hmm. I would be scared to death try to fake the Mars mission because it's going to be completely fake. If you try to fake it, it'll be torn apart in a week. So it's never going to happen.
You know, and that is interesting. That is that bodes well for the common person about you talk about the internet hive mind, because information is instantaneous, and if you say something, it better be factual, because it'll go within a second and be around the world whether or not what you said is true and the facts behind. That's why a lot of these false flags are not working, because the information, and I don't know, it seems that, you know, when they talk about net neutrality and these types of things, you always know that somewhere in there, they're going to try to control information, because the system cannot go to where it wants to go if we know the truth.
Yeah, it's the double side of the sword, you know, because they use the technology to collect information on you. But I'm going to use a quote from that last Batman movie, where the one where Anne Hathaway was there, and she said, and she was really talking about the internet. She says, "Look, everything sticks," and it's so true. And that is not only instantaneous, but it's permanent. You know, once mm-hmm. it gets out there, it's copied so many times that it can never be removed.
Mm-hmm. Right. Never. And that's why we know Hillary's emails Lois Lerner's emails are still out there, and Hillary's emails are still out there. They may think they deleted them, but somebody's got them. You know, they do not go away, even if you have a so-called secure server. All right, here's a question for you. It says, let me read this. This is a scripture that our moderator Jade brought up. Isaiah 40:22. It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretches out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in. Is that talking about a flat earth?
Oh, yeah, it's talking about flat earth. And in fact, if you get Rob Skibon, absolutely mention that to him, because, you know, he'll have that one memorized. But the important part of that verse is, I'm sorry, that quote, is the circle of the earth, not the globe of the earth, not the sphere. And people are saying, well, you know, well, it's an older concept. It's like, no. The sphere is not, look, fruit has been around forever. That's a sphere. You know, it's the wheel, that's one thing. But the sphere is an old concept, and that's not what they said. They said the circle.
They did. So a round, in fact, in my background, I grabbed a screenshot from one of your videos. It is the flat earth that is round. And I know that was a challenging question earlier, but that, wow, that's a pretty good answer to that. So somebody had to challenge that.
There's more quotes than that. I mean, most of the Bible speaks of it as a circle, as a flattish disc, and again, you can look. I mean, yeah, there may be a few passages here and there, but it's overwhelmingly leans toward the flat model.
Okay. Well, you know, and I'm going to go back to a defense. I don't know if a guest for one of our guests in the live chat thought I was going after them about, say, challenging you when you were given information on the planes. The correct answer is to a rebuttal to somebody's claim is to research it. But I was in that same position years ago, and everybody that knows the show and watched it for a long time will tell you that, you know, I was a pro fluoride guy. Yeah. And if somebody said fluoride is a toxic chemical made from the smokestacks of the production of phosphates, I would say you're crazy. The government would never allow that. Fluoride is great for you. And I would just call them, I would call them a liar. I said, man, you're just a freak and you're anti-government. You probably got this tinfoil hat running around in the forest.
Yeah.
You know, I would have responded that way. I was trained to respond that way.
And I hear you. And what I try to tell people, like the one you had on or that was in the chat room, is like, look, give this thing 60 seconds, give it 2 minutes. And I'm not saying that it has to be my video, but you will see some really, really weird stuff. I'm not just pulling this out of nowhere.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right, and let's. Okay, exactly. You've been given some very good information on that there, Mark. Here's from Pennsylvania. What do you think about Neil Adams and his expanding Earth theory?
I mean, it could be expanding, but in a puddle system, you don't need to. Even though officially it doesn't conflict because you could have an expanding flattish system, it's not my favorite. So okay. I just don't like it.
All right. And moving on, this question's just flying in here now. It had been all night, really, so we probably missed a whole bunch, but we'll do what we can with the time we have. Okay. What about the ability to see beyond the curvature of the Earth indicating something's up?
Ability to see beyond the curvature of the Earth. I'm not sure if I know what they're talking about.
That question really needs to be rephrased there. I don't quite understand it either.
Are they saying see actually the curvature of the Earth?
Hmm.
Because if that's what they're saying, maybe that's what they're saying. Mm-hmm. Because there's some people that like go to the beach, and you will see videos on this, and they'll say, oh, yeah, I see the curve, right? People in planes all the time will say, oh, yeah, I see the curve. It's like, okay, here's what you do. I told somebody this morning, it's like, you think you see the curve? Take a picture with your cell phone or whatever camera that you have. Take it on your home computer. Put it up on the screen. And then you don't need a ruler. You could use a piece of paper. And then you'll notice it's flat.
Mm-hmm.
And if to date, nobody has produced any pictures to anybody online that shows that there's a curve.
Okay. Philip from Georgia. What about Atlantis? Did it exist?
Yes.
Okay.
Probably at least one version back, maybe two, maybe one. I mean, Bimini Road doesn't seem to be that old, mm-hmm. but I believe it was one of the previous civilizations. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I got a statement, not a question for you, but somebody wrote in and said, we got to have you back on because they're trying to formulate questions and they're really intrigued by this. And so they're going to take some time to digest this. Sure. How about this question? Can the flat earth be overpopulated, and would it be in the controller's best interest to reduce that population?
Now we're going down a dark road. As a matter of fact, you know, it's been speculated that we may be hitting that, you know, like anything, you know, anything in a enclosed system, once it reaches maximum density, either by deliberate motion or an automated system, yeah, there could be a purging of some sort. Now, whether or not we're moved to something else or something horrible happens, I don't really want to speculate, but yeah.
Do you give any credence to the claims stated on the Georgia Guidestones?
That's a tough one, especially since that one thing where they popped that stone out of it, you know, that little cornerstone.
Yeah,
Where 500 million people should be the limit of this place? We're way past that, so I don't think that's part of the automated system. But don't know. The Guidestones is a bit of a mystery for me. It might be just wishful thinking on the authorities' part.
Okay, this question here: can you explain the hexagon on the pole of planet Saturn?
Yeah, I can explain, and in fact, that's one of the only things from NASA that I'll give credit for, because most of NASA's stuff they've been doing lately has been horrible production work. But the face on Mars and the hexagon thing on Saturn, very, very clever. Because again, whether you believe it or not, you're thinking about it. So it's like, oh, maybe that may be a real thing, or maybe it might not be. But while you're thinking about it, you're immediately, by default, seeing that you're on a globe. So it's a great globe reinforcement tool. But the short answer to that question is no, the Saturn thing isn't real because it doesn't make any difference. It's strictly a reinforcement push by NASA.
Mm-hmm. Mark, what do you think the reasoning is behind to trick us all into thinking we're on a sphere, on a globe?
From the authority, let's do this a different way. From the builder's standpoint, you need to do it because if we know we're enclosed, all we're going to do is focus on the fence. We are going to give all our efforts to the fence and to try to decipher what's going on there. But since 1956, the reason why authority doesn't want us to do it is because imagine the big five religions, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity. Imagine if they all, because they've all been looking for proof of God for the longest time, imagine if they all got their Holy Grail at the same time. They all got, you know, the handprint of God. If they all got a proof of intelligent design, there would be a monstrous shift in spirituality. Government and science would take a beating for a while. And even though they might be able to recover over 10, 20, 30 years, the decision was made back in 1956, like, you know what, we're not even going to deal with it. We're just going to hold on to this thing for as long as we can, and it seems like now it's starting to fall apart.
Hmm. All right, and here's a question from the live chat again. What impact would it have on society if the flat Earth belief was accepted?
We would become a lot better, that's for sure. And that's what I talked about at 11. And that is, regardless of if the builders showed up and revealed themselves, let's say just the structure was identified, what would happen there is people, especially from the religious side, people would start looking at themselves as being accountable for their own actions. So imagine this. I'll use the Santa Claus reference. And that is, the naughty and nice lists don't really mean anything until you see Santa Claus eating cookies in your living room. Then it does. So regardless of if the builders reveal themselves, you can't be sure if somebody's looking over your shoulder or not. So are you going to do anything bad? I firmly believe we would not. I believe that wars would end, hate crimes would end, racism would be taken down a whole bunch of notches, sexism would be taken down a couple pegs. Absolutely, I believe we would be better. In fact, in my opinion, it is one of the only things that would take us from the brink of where we're going right now. Maybe not a 180, but at least a 90-degree turn away from the cliff.
Hmm. And I'm a good term there with the flat Earth theory, but yeah, we are, it does seem, on the brink of something, and I don't think it bodes well for the civilization on the planet. But let me ask you something. Does the flat Earth modality, does that give credence to the idea, and I think you brushed over it in the first hour, that it indicates an intelligent design?
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely, it does. It. In fact, it is the if it has structure, if it's not, you know, something organic, you know, like a giant tree branch or something like that, it absolutely is.
You mean like an avatar?
Yeah, like an avatar, something like that. I mean, I don't think it's organic. I think this is a physical, mechanical structure of a severely advanced technology. And now, whether or not you want to say that's divine technology, or whether or not you want to say that God subcontracted it out, either way, they're beings that are way, way further down the road than us.
Hmm. All right. Oak Lord from Maine says this. Thoughts on science project balloons that go up about 20 miles, and some show flat Earth, and others, i.e. NASA, shows clear curvature, yet both photos are about the same altitude.
Excellent, excellent. I know this. This guy's on my side. I love it. And in fact, I'll send you a picture as soon as this thing's over, where you have the Red Bull weather balloon the guy jumped out, right? Mm-hmm. And he had a fisheye lens, and it was about like 120,000 feet, and it was the Earth was severely curved. But you take another balloon in almost the identical location by, I think it was called Dog Cam, and it was sent up about 110,000, 115,000 feet, and it shows no curve at all. The only difference is Dog Cam didn't get national media attention, and the Red Bull thing was completely endorsed by all the major media groups, including NASA.
Hmm.
So yeah, fisheye lens. Oh. When you go up that high, depending on what picture you're looking at, it all comes down to the lens you're using.
Mm-hmm. Question, Will aliens reveal a flat Earth truth to us?
Ooh, that's a tough one. Because if aliens did, could you trust them? You know, at that point, it's like, say an alien race came in and said, oh yeah, by the way, we built the dome. We'd have to take their word for it. Or let's say a government comes in, simulates aliens, who then say, we were the ones that built the dome. You know, then you got layers of mistrust. But yeah, that's very possible that could happen. In fact, you know, could that be tied in with what's going on this fall? We'll see.
Hmm. All right. Jimmy wants to know, is the sun much closer? And if so, why can't we shoot a laser at it and get the real distance like we can the moon?
Okay. Yes, is much closer. Who's shooting the laser? Because lasers that powerful are only controlled by a very small group of people, including NASA, you know, Department of Science. So, yeah, you probably could, but you're never going to be able to test it independently. It's mm-hmm. never going to happen. They're never going to let you do it.
Well, Mark, do you believe we went to the moon?
Not a chance.
Not a chance.
Not a chance.
And that goes back to your predictability that we'll never go to Mars.
No, no, no. The moon missions have been so dismantled, and for those listeners, you want to have some fun, I'll tell you how bad NASA's gotten eaten up recently. They have a second Wikipedia site. There's been such NASA's gotten so beat up that they had to release a second Wikipedia section called Third-Party Confirmation of Apollo Landings. And in the first paragraph, they say, as a disclaimer, this page has nothing to do with NASA, the United States government, or anybody else affiliated. It is strictly third-party confirmations. Basically, they're saying, look, don't take our word for it. Listen to all these other people. Listen to the Chinese. Listen to India. You know, listen to the Japanese. And it's ridiculous. They confirm nothing. But that's how bad it's gotten for NASA. And that was released, I think, just last year.
All right, so let's clear up the fact whether or not we went to the moon.
No, absolutely nobody went to the moon.
Okay.
But here's the reason. Okay, that was bugging me for a number of years, and that was it's the old argument, because you know the moon has been argued for a long time, and the argument was from the people that believe we went to the moon. It's like, why would they fake it? Why would they bother faking it? And that bugged me because they were right. It was like, why would you fake it? It's like, it doesn't make any sense. Yeah, you put the flag up there, you know, wave it around, and you go America, yay, but it didn't make any sense. But once I got to the enclosed system, then it made perfect sense. And that was because it changed it from a question to a statement. And that was, it's not that they wanted to fake the moon missions. They had to fake the moon missions. I would have faked the moon missions. Because if you don't fake it, eventually you're going to get private corporations that are going to get involved. Sooner or later, you have got to fake a picture of the Earth. That's the big thing. That's wow. one of the primary reasons NASA was created in the first place. And that was, you can't just hand people a picture of the Earth in 1972 and say, oh yeah, by the way, this is where you live, right? Mm-hmm. You can't do that. So the only thing you can do is unfortunately, it's going to cost you billions in adjusted dollars. You have to create a fake rocket program just to fake the picture, just to give the reason that you faked the picture. It's the most expensive picture in history. Mm-hmm. And so nobody went to the moon. It absolutely look, there's so many documentaries out there on just destroy the moon. It's gotten cartoonish to this point. But once you take away the moon, the rest of it becomes in doubt. The ISS becomes in doubt. Satellites becomes in doubt. The space shuttle program, everything. Mm-hmm. It just starts to crumble after that.
Mm. You know, that reminds me of a current event this week. A woman by the name of Rachel Dojal, who is a white woman faking to be black, and she made her way to the top of the NAACP in Spokane. But when she said, "Here's my black father," the Twitter universe shot right back with, I don't know how long it took. It wasn't very long. It said, "No, that's not your father, and here's your birth certificate." And so when, and it was white folks. So, yeah. You know, but the instantaneous rebuttal of this, and as you say, the internet hive mind, these things aren't happening anymore. And it sounds like the moon hoax sort of has run into that realm that we have way more facts out in the internet universe than ever has been given to us through the national channels.
Yeah. And the demographics have really changed too. And that is, you know, cause I'm in my 40s, but if you're in your 30s or younger, most of those people have real, real doubts about the moon mission stuff. Because, you know, they grow up in high tech and they're just not seeing it. However, if you're older than a certain age, you know, you're skewed more. It's like, oh yeah, we went, you know, I watched it on television or I listened to it on the radio or I knew somebody that worked for Jet Propulsion Laboratories or whatever. But the hive mind has really descended upon certain things. And again, the social media really helps because the speed at which stuff is crossing now, where it used to take, you know, weeks and days, now it takes minutes. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing how fast some of this stuff gets revealed. So, yeah. Anyway, I digress. The short version is, no, anyone that does their research on the moon, it is ridiculous. Forget about it. You can even take the flat Earth enclosed world out of the equation. The moon mm-hmm. on its own as a standalone is a ridiculous mm-hmm. concept now.
Well, I asked you a question earlier in the program about looking forward. Do you see any other topics you want to investigate or apply the open mind theory and investigation process to it? Is there anything in the past? Let's go to the past. Is there anything in the past that you have sort of exploded myths that you have been taught besides the enclosed Earth theorem?
I've looked at just about every conspiracy that there was. So, I mean, again, part of the reason I even came back around to this one is because everything else seemed to be old hat. You know, I don't want to necessarily bring up, you know, all the ones you probably know, I know. Mm-hmm. But there was nothing really new. So when I looked at this, it was more out of, okay, it's the only one I haven't looked at, so I might as well take a look. It's the only card in the deck. It wasn't even the Joker. It was that stupid instruction playing card that you see in some decks. It's like how to play Pinochle or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. It's that stupid card. Mm-hmm. But as far as going forward and looking at other things, this is my number one. It's the reason why, again, when you talk to Rob Skiba, it sucked him in to the point where he doesn't care about anything else. Because if this thing, I think that's what it's become now. Because again, if you look on YouTube and you just type in flat Earth and set the filter to like 24 hours, mm-hmm. so much content is out there. It's like, it's almost become, for lack of a better term, a gold rush because everybody's trying to find it. Everybody's trying to find that little thing, you know, because the hive mind now is working as it's getting bigger and it's growing and it's reaching its arms out and it's trying to find a mistake. Not necessarily in the flat Earth theory, but a mistake in what NASA may have done, what the governments may have done, maybe mm-hmm. something the Chinese program has done, or JAXA, or any of the others. Everybody's trying to find the golden ticket, the brass ring. Mm-hmm. And it's weird because there's this weird enthusiasm out there. It's everyone's feeding off each other. And so, yeah, that's what I'm going to be doing as well. I'm just going mm-hmm. forward, and I still have a few more clues up my sleeve, but at this point, I'm soaking in just about every little piece of information coming at me and saying, okay, does this connect in some small way, mm-hmm. And what will break this thing open?
As Jade, our moderator, said in the live chat, edgies love a good mystery. Here's a question for you. Is there any such thing then, based on the flat Earth enclosure, as a geosynchronous orbit?
No, I don't believe so. And I'll throw this at you. People have asked me about satellites, and I know I addressed this a little bit earlier, but I've got to mention it, and that is, anyone wants to know what I think of a geosynchronous orbit, look up on YouTube, look up ISS, which stands for International Space Station, hoax. Here's the thing. We have the technology, and people say, fine, if there's something flying around the sky that you think is the ISS, that's fine, but there's no people in it, and they know this because the footage that they release, and not, you know, there's been, especially, they're releasing footage every month, and it's horrible. The interior footage is so badly produced, then I have to ask, why are you faking people on a space station when you should be able to do it? And the only reason you're faking it is because you have to fake it, because you can't get them up there. Now, whatever's up there, is it a hologram? Is it a special spy plane that looks like a space station? I have no idea. But if I can't trust the ISS, then how can I trust any satellites at all? At this point, I'm not sure that satellite transmissions aren't being bounced off of a combination of AWACS, specially equipped spy planes, or they could be bouncing the signals off the structure itself. I mean, look what HARP can do, or officially what HARP can or cannot do. If HARP is as good as they say it is, then maybe it's creating weather patterns not just by bouncing it off the atmosphere, but bouncing it off a hard surface.
Hmm. All right, and we have this question from Doc Warrior. Do you think mobile phones, Wi-Fi, and other electronic devices are keeping people from breaking free from this reality?
Mobile phones, smartphones, and I haven't said this yet. You have an exclusive on this one. Are the bane of our existence right now, and that is we've sucked people in at a young age, and I deliberately, to this day, to those people who don't know, I do not own a smartphone or even a mobile phone. Oh. And it's deliberate because it has taken over people's lives. I live in a college town out here in Boulder, Colorado, and you can drive by any bus station when school's in, and everybody is looking down. A UFO could fly right over their heads. No one would even see it. Physically not see it because nobody's looking up. Everyone's looking straight down on their phones. So yeah, the mobile phone and combine smartphones with social media is the perfect storm that is diminishing us as a civilization, in my opinion.
I saw, I am one. Unfortunately, I guess I have to admit, I do have a Facebook account and
it's okay.
And, I saw a graphic come flying through there one day and it had people, I guess they went to heaven. And two angels were talking. I don't know if you've seen it somewhere, but it said they were looking at the people and he said, we got some new people, they're all so sad because they're all looking down. And they were all in heaven. They were looking down at their hand trying to see where their cell phone was. You know.
There you go. So, I'll throw a little wrench in the apocalypse. You want to find an interesting apocalypse scenario?
Let's see.
Here's a fun little wrinkle. Just turn off the network. All you have to do is turn off Verizon and watch what happens to people. You don't even have to start a nuclear war. It would just be chaos. Mm-hmm. People wouldn't even know what to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's apocalypse movies now that would have to be rewritten because you'd have people carrying around cell phones with dead batteries that they would look for cars to charge up just to see if the network was up.
Yeah.
Drive me insane.
Yeah. And the iPhones users, when it all breaks down, they're going to be speaking in their phone, Siri, what do I do? What do I do? You know? she ain't going to answer.
Siri, how do I kill a zombie?
This is not going to work. How do you explain NASA's live stream off the ISS showing the Earth is round?
Oh, do not show me. All right.
Got you. You can't get out of this one. You're stuck.
No, I don't want to get out of this one. This one's a great one. All right, I counter it with this. compare the live stream, which is all oceans and clouds, which can be faked really easy, with that time-lapse crap that shows all the cities. It's usually, they usually do a night shot where they're flying over the cities and you see all the yellow lights down below. But when you do the live shots, you never see that. Ever, ever, ever. That ISS stream is completely and utterly faked. If you do not believe me, go out, rent Gravity again. Watch it. You know, Sandra Bullock. I know it's not a movie you want to watch twice. That movie is beautiful, and it's very, very technically well done. If you think for a second that NASA isn't going to release some stuff, some live footage, you're kidding yourself. But do they show anything underneath you? Do a time-lapse. There's some great videos on YouTube that show this. It's like whenever you're flying over, there's been guys that just sit there and watch it. Believe me, the hive mind's on it. Where it's like they fly over. It's like, okay, 2 hours later, nothing but clouds. 2 hours later, you know, ocean. 2 hours later, nothing but clouds. They only show the cities in the time-lapse shots. That way you don't know where they are. Hmm. So, no, it's absolutely fake. Fake, 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 fake.
Okay.
Sorry.
Well, let me ask you. I want to do like a rapid fire fake or true.
I'll answer in under 10 seconds. Any question?
Okay. Sandy Hook.
Oh, you're going to change it.
Yeah.
Sandy Hook, it was one of the worst regional ops I've ever seen in my life. Whoever was in charge of that thing, and I'm talking from the government standpoint, should be fired, taken out back, and shot in that order. Or maybe in the reverse order. Absolutely horrible, 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 fake, fake, fake from day one. I'll answer, but I want to follow up to that, and that is the easiest way to do it was a guy that named Max Malone. He said, he goes, find me a single, he was willing to pay like $1,000, show me a single video shot, even 5 seconds long, of kids running out of that building. You will not find it. There's only like 3 shots taken. They're all still shots. We have no idea how that photographer got in there and took those shots. Fake, 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 fake.
Boston bombing.
Ugh. Wow, you're just softballing them to me. Also horribly fake. What were they thinking, not just disabling, just removing all the cell phones? Again, that's why you can't do a regional operation nowadays. You can't fake it because all those people with those cell phones, that's the one good thing about having those people with their cell phones. They look down. As soon as something happens, they immediately pull them up and hit the camera. It's almost like a quick draw, you know, like with a six gun. And with all those shots coming from all those cameras, oh, yeah, they dissected that thing in 2 seconds. It was also fake. Horrible. Okay. Not as bad as Sandy Hook, but still bad.
Okay. Is Paul McCartney been replaced with another person?
Tell me you're not going to give me a Dallas Gold Bug thing. No, I don't. I'm not. Okay, I'm open-minded, of course, because I'm a flat Earth guy.
Okay.
But when it comes to clones, maybe. But it's not that I don't believe it. It's just that I don't care. Because it's like, all right, does it really affect much in the way of anything? It's possible, mm-hmm. I suppose. But it's not something I subscribe to.
Okay. But all right. Awesome. They're starting to fly in now. You ready? Let's keep going.
Keep going.
All right. Is the scars on Obama's head indicate he's a Manchurian candidate?
Ooh, that's a good one. Possible, but I don't think it really matters because I'll turn that a different way. And that is, remember the general from the last Superman movie, that black guy?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I hate to say it, that black guy because I just don't know his name. Know. The black general.
Yes.
He was on air. You can look him up. He got caught in an interview, and I think it was audio only. I don't think it was video, where he was basically taking credit for Obama's presidency. He was going, look, this Obama trained with me as an actor. So do I think Obama's a Manchurian candidate? No. Do I think he's a very, not very polished actor, but he's had a lot of crash course training? Yes, I do. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, he's an actor.
All right. Was 9/11 an inside job?
Yes. So there's layers to that. I was a big believer that since the beginning that 9/11 was an inside job. Mm-hmm. Now, I was also one of those guys that when I first saw the videos that came out that said there was no planes, I had the knee-jerk reaction, just like people with the flat earth saying, oh, Mark's crazy about flat earth. I said the same thing about no planes in the 9/11 thing. But once I watched September Clues, you know, because somebody got me into that later, mm-hmm. I started staring at that and I was going, you know, from a technical standpoint, from a gaming design, production standpoint, I was going, wow, that's pretty damn clever. I'll throw this one thing, and that is for those people that believe that there were planes, look, aluminum, and I'm a big, you know, I'm a big ballistics guy, you know, love, you know, shooting. And that is, if you shoot an aluminum bullet at a steel target, you could shoot all day long, and that gun's going to wear out before that steel target goes down. So tell me how a very slow aluminum bullet got through a steel target that was the World Trade Center. That's that's my closure on that one.
Or 10 was it 10 feet of concrete, the estimated of the rings of the Pentagon?
Yeah, that too. Yeah, it was
evidently aluminum could be a deadly weapon.
It was not just an inside job.
Huh?
It was a very, very sophisticated, even more sophisticated than I gave him credit for, inside job.
Okay. And what about the missing planes?
Oh, like the Malaysian flights?
Mm-hmm. Where are they going?
It's hard to say with those because, one, they were in the Southern Hemisphere, so they obviously weren't tracked. Do I believe that we could lose a flagship 777 plane? No. No, of course not. I mean, that's the whole point of GPS, right? It's a global positioning system. You don't lose things. But did those planes take off in the first place? Or did they exist in the first place? Did they even leave anywhere? Hard to say. I would like to believe that those planes were reserved for something else, you know, for a later operation, mm-hmm. or maybe even tied to that Russia thing over in Ukraine a while back.
Mm-hmm. Is Jade Helm preparing us for martial law?
Something's coming. And I don't say this to be grim or doomsday-ish, but I have had, you know, since I've done this thing in February, I have had at least five different people come to me. They claim they've had special abilities. I'm not going to say they're full-blown psychics or anything.
But we're having a psychic on next week, so.
Oh, there you go. Ask this person. But all of them have said independently, none of these people know each other, that something's coming and they can't put their finger on it. It's like they're trying to describe the shape of fog. And Jade Helm, if it is real, is just part of it. Is the enclosed world thing part of it? Yeah, maybe. Is there going to be a stage, you know, a celestial event? Hard to say, but it seems like, you know, everyone keeps... I didn't even really pay much attention to it initially. They said, oh yeah, September 23rd, something's coming. I was going, what the heck, September 23rd? No freaking idea. I know that 23 is in my email address. I don't think that has anything to do with it. But it... Is Jade Helm coming? Yeah, maybe. Maybe. But again, I don't want to spook people because, you know, it could also be the horror movie cat coming out of the closet thing. Mm. I've seen too many cats over the years and no killer.
The U.S. debt problems, are they fake or real?
No, oh, God. Look, there's – when the financial crisis happened at the end of 2008, beginning of 2009 – I was in that sector. I was in a data mining sector that dealt with staffing, and we watched everything collapse from a hiring standpoint all over the United States in all sectors all at the same time, and the stock market went through the freaking floor, and now it's up what pushing 18,000 again, mm-hmm. which is ridiculous because it's completely artificial. The United States debt is so it's absolutely real. It's absolutely horrible. The only reason we're even talking right now, because the financial our economy hasn't collapsed, is because we've been pumping billions and billions and billions into the bond markets, and it's again, they could shut it down anytime they wanted. I'm just trying to figure out what they're holding on to. They could have closed it down in 2009. They didn't. Here we are, 2015. It's like they're waiting for something. I just can't, again, like the psychics, I can't put my finger on it.
Have you made any preparations for any possible event?
Oh, yeah, I'm a prepper. I probably didn't even mention, I haven't mentioned that in any of my bio. If anyone wants to have some fun, I'm going to revamp this website, but go to urbansurvivalusa.com, mm-hmm. and I wrote a big thing. I did that after the financial crisis in 2009. In fact, if anybody wants a free prepper guide, just email me at msargent23@comcast.net. I made a 100-page thing called Empty Shelves, which basically talks about everything you need I made it generic, so like a long-term mm-hmm. power outage. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't specify zombies or aliens or anything like that, but it covers everything from food, water, weapons, mental attitude, the whole nine yards. And I've gotten a PDF file, and I've just been firing it off to people.
And how much does that cost?
Free.
Wow.
It's absolutely free. You guys, anybody who emails me, I will send it off in 2 seconds, and it's just a simple little two-meg PDF file, and it's It's an interesting little read. I highly recommend it. It took me a little while to write it, but I wrote it after the financial crisis. And I wrote it mostly because of the Katrina thing, because after Katrina, 75% of the people that came back, they still didn't prep anything. It's like you just were evacuated from your city. You're walking around in salt water that was filthy, and you come back, and you're still not going to get a couple cans of food and a case of bottled water. And you know, the denial was unbelievable. So that's why I wrote it.
Somebody in the live chat says, "Mark, you are as amazing as Daniel."
I'm not going to go that far.
No, I don't know if you could. Well, maybe you can.
I'm not a cowboy.
Going back to this flat Earth thing, you know, there was a congressman. I remember he was testifying in a committee in Congress talking to a general, and he said that there are so many people on Guam that if they went to one side, it would flip over. At first, I thought he was crazy, but maybe he's not crazy.
It's soldiers on Guam?
No, he said that Guam is so overpopulated that if they went to one side, the island would tip over.
Oh, okay.
A U.S. congressman said that a couple months ago.
That's weird. Well, if Guam was an interesting thing, everyone wants to look up some secret history of the United States. The Spanish-American War, we traded one battleship, which we sunk deliberately, and fought, you know, the Spanish-American War, and we got, for one battleship, we got Puerto Rico, Guam, the Philippines, and we almost got Cuba, you know, for the price of one battleship. Yeah, I know 200 guys died on it, but, I mean, that's a heck of an investment.
Okay. Oh, we have a request for your email address again.
Probably for that empty shelves thing. It is M, as in Mark, Sargent, Sargent, 23@comcast.net.
Okay, I think you picked a lot of people's interest in that. Well, now, is it better in an end-time catastrophe scenario to be on a flat Earth or to be in a round Earth? Which one's more to our advantage?
Flat Earth. Because globe Earth, there's way too many other variables that you have to deal with. Flat Earth, you don't have to. In a flat system, an enclosed system, you don't have to deal with. Well, I shouldn't. I'm going to jinx this if I say this. Anything that happens would be artificial. So, like any sort of tectonic shift or volcanic activity or anything like that would be artificial. Globe would be all natural. So there's a lot more to risk. Plus, you know, killer meteorites and all that doesn't happen in an enclosed system. Because people ask me about meteorites. They say, how does that factor into it? And it's like, well, it's easy from a design standpoint. You just add, you know, some metal ore at speed from the top of this thing, let the friction of the atmosphere do the rest, hope you don't aim for any populated cities, which is why that thing that happened in Russia a couple of years got a little dicey. You don't know who fell asleep at the switch on that one.
Mm-hmm. So, Mark, if you're say, you've prepped and the catastrophes hit, now, two people come to your door. Yep. Are you going to ask them which one believes in a flat Earth and the one that does? Are you going to allow them to come in? And the round earther guy, would you say, look, man, you've been living a lie your whole life and you believe the system, and that because you fell for it, you have facilitated that, and we can't have you facilitating the recreated Earth.
Is that your question?
Yeah.
That's a good one. No, I wouldn't necessarily care when it came to
around a flat Earth litmus test. I guess that would. I want
to. No. When it comes to the apocalypse situation, it would be much more basic than that. It's like, okay, you know, are they my neighbor? Am I my friend? When it comes to the flat Earth, round Earth views, at that point, that would be something that would have to be later. Which actually ties into the fact that it's like, okay, let's say, if you wanted to distract people from the whole flat Earth, round Earth argument, you would want to stage an event that was so big that it wouldn't even be in their crosshairs. Mm-hmm. And that's what you would do so an apocalyptic situation, that's perfect for that. Yeah, because the last thing you would care about, it's like, who cares? You know, there's zombies running down the street, or there's aliens in the sky, or whatever. Right. Who cares if it's round Earth or flat Earth? We'll deal with that later. But, you know.
Okay.
It matters. It still matters.
Okay. Mark, what's your opinion of the Norway spiral?
That was a weird one. That thing was so freaking weird. I think it was real, but was it a glitch or was it just a visual test? I'm not sure. It didn't seem like it really did anything other than it was a great little light show. Do I think it was us or do I think it was the builders? I think it was probably us. Because it was small enough. I mean, it could have been part of the Project Bluebeam. Not sure what they're doing with it, though. Mark, it was like an isolated incident. It's not like you saw him around the world. I'm actually
going to tell you what that was.
What was it?
Well, so you see, we're on a flat Earth, and so we're in this dome. There's this dome, and what happened was one of the Earth spaceships that our military has developed, and they just said they're flying a spherical UFO. It went through that dome, and what happened was that spiral was them exiting, and it was closing. So the spiral was actually the dome closing on itself after something had exited it.
That's really a cool one. Did you just come up with that?
I did. Right
that's
now.
That's great.
That sounds great.
That's thinking outside of the box or outside of the dome in that case. That's a great little thing. I never thought of that. That's fantastic.
Well, I mean, you have to think off the grid because the programming, I can't stand the fact that there's things that I probably believe that are not true because they have been programmed into me. And I hope everybody who's watching this show feels the same way. You have to question everything, no matter how basic you think it is, because you want to be a free, autonomous being making your own decisions based on what is actually true and not what helps somebody else. Because all these lies really just perpetuate somebody else's control. And they're sitting at the top. Like I've always said, Mark, we're talking about prepping and things. Well, we know the government has underground cities prepared, stock full with jacuzzis. I mean, the best lifestyle. It is not going to be a Spartan lifestyle down there. I'm saying if they go down there, I'm going to be waiting for them when they come up out of there.
I totally hear you.
All right. And if anybody has any further questions, you can pop them in real quick. We're getting near the end of the broadcast. Here's another question. It says, do you think the movement of hurricanes and the jet stream reflect a flat Earth?
Maybe, but actually, when it comes to the hurricane, well, the jet stream is absolutely part of the flat Earth system, no question. It's just a giant air conditioning system, and it works in conjunction with the underwater conveyor system. When it comes to hurricanes, I don't really trust hurricanes anymore because I've got that Katrina thing looked too much like it was aimed, like it was being targeted in there. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to weather like hurricanes now, I almost think that's somebody's government. I'm not necessarily say it's us. That's just, playing games.
Hmm.
That's just me, though.
And I think we answered this. I think you answered this question. Is the Earth the only flat planet? But you believe they're all flat, right? Or they're not even there.
I think the Earth is the only flat planet, but I think there are other planets that are other worlds outside of this one. So it could be that when somebody says, oh, they went to Venus, they actually just went to a different puddle or pond that was outside this. But as far as stuff in the sky, no. Sun and the moon, three-dimensional objects, Mars, Saturn, Jupiter, all the other planets and the stars, they are just a beautifully rendered image like we've been doing in games since 2004.
Mark, you said in the first hours we brought you onto the program that you're out there in Colorado. Did you inadvertently, by accident, end up there through certain circumstances, or did you pick that area because it's a good place to prep?
That's an excellent question. And it's a little of both, actually, because I had the chance when I got to play games professionally years ago, it turned out the publisher that wanted me to be their ringer was out in Boulder, Colorado. And I'd never been to Colorado before, but I knew geographically that because I didn't trust the oceans and tsunamis and potential global shift. Of course, I don't think that's true now, but that's I jumped at the chance to come out of Colorado. Colorado is one of the safest places. I mean, there's a reason why Denver is the backup capital of the United States. If Washington D.C. falls, Denver becomes the capital. There's a reason why NORAD, Cheyenne Mountain, the Air Force Academy, Space Command, all the fun stuff is out here. So that's part of the reason I stayed here for so long.
Mm. And now, is there other areas of the United States you would recommend people to gravitate toward for some coming apocalypse?
Boy, I don't know. I mean, I would if you had the means, if you wanted to stay away from the apocalypse, you'd want to stay away from the Eastern Seaboard entirely, of course. And if you really, honestly, if you wanted to, play it safe, you'd want to be west of the Mississippi somewhere, because, and I'm saying that only because of the atomic power plants, that most of which are situated east of the Mississippi. So you'd want to be, you know, over in the western states somewhere, if that was me. Mm-hmm. I mean, but again, I don't want people to relocate. If you have a beautiful place, you have a beautiful place. The eastern seaboard, though, that'd be a death trap. That'd be the last place you'd want to be.
Mm-hmm. Somebody wrote in and said, if they could look at one video, and you mentioned a lot of good links throughout the show, people have to have their pens ready at hand when you talk about it. If they can watch one video out there after this show, what would it be?
You mean a flat earth video?
Yeah.
Probably yours? Just the introduction that I did. Again, in enclosedworld.com or YouTube, or if you just Google Flat Earth Clues, the first one, you got to start at the beginning. And the first one really is the one I want to make a good impression on, which was called just the Flat Earth Clues, Guide to the Flat Earth, or Flat Earth mm-hmm. Clues Introduction. And if you make it through that and you're still saying, there's nothing there, I mean, it's only like 12 minutes. Then don't do it again anymore. But there's 11 clues after that, which are good. And if you can make it through all those, there's a playlist on my YouTube channel with about a dozen people that aren't me. That it's called Flat Earth Related, and everybody's got some wonderful rants that are out there. And there's so much stuff out there now. You'll be amazed when you start digging into it. If you go down this rabbit hole, though, I gotta warn you in advance. That whole ignorance is bliss thing is going to go away. You can't, again, it is the red pill, blue pill thing. You will not come back from this the same. You cannot, once you go down it, you're not going to come back and grab onto the globe and say, I'm a globe person again. You won't do it.
Hey, I'm looking at your website. Now, on the left side, it says Flat Earth Clues. Are you, in that section, are you directing people to go to the videos to look for these clues?
Yeah. On the top of the screen, you'll see videos, interviews, transcripts, Strange World, and then Home. Flat Earth, that's just announcing. That's not a clickable button. That just says that, look, Flat Earth Clues, I'm the guy that created Flat Earth Clues. The reason is because I made enclosedworld.com. I was never going to take flatearthclues.com on Facebook or the main website, and I encouraged somebody else to grab it, and they did. Mm-hmm. So it's just to let people know that, look, I'm actually the guy that made Flat Earth Clues.
Okay. All right. But then for your actual produced material, click on the videos?
Yeah. Just click on videos. Okay. And then, right, you know, you'll see the first one. It's in order. It starts out with the Flat Earth Clues introduction, and then just goes clue one, clue two, all the way down to 11. And those, you know, you can burn through all of those in under a couple hours. You know, some of them are less than 10 minutes, some of them are a little bit more, but they're broken up in segments, and they're easy to digest. It's just a narrative, just like me talking, just with some slides for visual. Mm-hmm. But you know, some people, you don't even have to. I'm descriptive mm-hmm. enough that you don't even have to watch the video to do it. Mm-hmm. And it's started this wave of things out there that. Again, I'm not going to take credit for all the stuff because really, for me, it just came, the Flat Earth stuff that was out there just came across as like the staticky radio station. And all I did literally was just walk up, turn it a quarter, you know, make a quarter turn. The station comes in clear, and then everybody's going, oh my God, what is this new station? It's like, it's not a new station. It's just a station that no one's paid attention to for hundreds of years.
Mm. All right. And do you have any, has anybody ever thought about offering you some kind of deal maybe to make a Flat Earth movie? What life would be?
Not yet. There's some interesting stuff that I'm not going to jinx it I got that radio show on Truth Frequency Radio. That came out pretty quick. Mm-hmm. Got a newspaper column out of Canada. That was kind of fun. But again, it's only been February, so yeah, I'm looking for stuff. I'm not counting anything out at this point. I'm just gonna go where it takes me.
Well, your whole presentation is done so well. You add credibility for people to even begin to research that, because if you go to some websites, you go there and say perhaps maybe somebody with a flat earth view, and if that website looks off center, it's just an easy word. You know, then people move along, but you know, you've done it very professionally, and it looks to me like you've done a really good job with these videos too as well.
Well, thank you. I got to give credit to Da Vinci Coders, the guys that I've been taking classes with, you know, cranking up my Java skills, because I couldn't have finished the site myself without them. I really wanted to do it myself because I was going to make a lot of changes. And as far as the videos go, you know, I've trained enough people in software over the years. A proprietary software that I got the knack of doing a pretty slick slideshow, And it just worked out naturally. That and whatever was beamed into my head as far as the narrative goes, I don't know where that came from.
All right, well, Mark, we're right here at the end of the broadcast. I appreciate you staying late and having an extended segment with us.
Oh, yeah, no worries.
All right, anything else you'd like to say to the viewing or listening audience?
No, other than that, it's been a lot of fun. Again, it is a tough topic to get your head around. It's the biggest. If you can get your head around this, you can get your head around anything. And I'm not saying, it's like, look, if you're comfortable in the globe, hey, fine, you know, have a beer or a shot of Jack and, you know, enjoy your globe for as long as you can, because I got a feeling it's going to start changing here real soon.
Okay. Well, Mark Sargent, I appreciate you coming on the broadcast. Can we have you on again sometime?
You bet. And one last, I'd be happy to do one last thing. I say this at the end of all my videos, and that is, Ten Commandments is one thing, but I got one, and that is treat others better than you treat yourself.
Okay. Well said. Way to end the broadcast. I liked it.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, everybody. That was Mark Sargent talking about the flat earth reality, challenging the round earth conspiracy hoax.